We are going to talk about bravery and fear and fearlessness today. And I want to start by asking you if you have ever experienced fear. Anybody who experienced fear, please raise your hands. Okay. Anybody who never experienced fear in life? Not even one? No brave man or brave woman now? We have all experienced fear. If you look at the anatomy of fear, you will notice that fear is always of something that is unknown. We are never afraid of something that we know. Fear as such, the emotion of fear, is related to something that we don't know. A very interesting experiment was once conducted on fear in Kumaon Hills in India, where they have a lot of tigers roaming around. And people are afraid of those tigers. They're man-eaters. Kipling wrote a book on that, The Man-Eaters of Kumaon. Those man-eaters, those tigers roam around. And people go and have to set up special machans or special scaffolding to sit on top of them to watch those tigers. The emotion of fear was studied in a few subjects to see. All they were all wired and all that for measurement to see what causes fear. When the man was let loose into the forest, the man was not told that the tigers had been separated by a big wire mesh and they could not really come and attack. They could growl and they could come towards that side, but they could not really attack. But the subjects were not told this. The subject said that we will save you, and people are there with guns, but you have to face the tiger. The fear was the most when there was no tiger. When they said the tiger might come, the fear was the most. When a tiger actually appeared, fear changed into another emotion. The emotion being, what can I do? How would I fight it? How would I escape? All other ideas came up, but the fear itself disappeared. It's a very classic experiment that was done to prove that fear lasts while we don't know where the tiger is going to come from. The lack of knowledge created the fear. The moment the knowledge came, it was replaced by other emotions, how to deal with the problem. It happens with us all the time in life. When we don't know what is going to happen, we are afraid. So fear is always of the unknown. If that is as simple as that, that fear is of the unknown, the answer to the problem of fear is, know it. Don't leave anything unknown. Just know it. So knowledge is the answer to fear. If you get knowledge, you're not afraid. Such a simple statement. It's true. If you have knowledge, you will not be afraid. What kind of knowledge will take fear away? Well, let us see what kind of ignorance, what kind of lack of knowledge creates fear. You will find your inability to know who you are is creating most of the fears. If you knew who you are, you would not be afraid. Why deal with each situation separately? Why say, in this situation, I don't know, I don't have the answer, so let me pick up knowledge. Why not get knowledge of your own power, of your own self, and get rid of fear? In a dream, there can be many things that can frighten us. Many sequences come in the dream that frighten us. We can deal with that fear either one by one by becoming strong to deal with those sequences, or we can wake up and be unafraid knowing it was all a dream. By waking up, all the fears disappear at once. So we have two choices. Either to deal with the problem of fear episode by episode, incident by incident, or tackle the root of fear and get to know how all these situations that are causing fear are being created. Have the knowledge of the creative process itself. And the knowledge of the creative process removes all fear forever. I have seen very few fearless people, but the few I have seen are the ones who have self-realized, who have realized their own self, who have found out what the self is, how the whole situation is being created. Once they find the creative process, fear disappears. If you could know that consciousness is generating this experience around you, you would not be afraid. But if you feel that these experiences are real and they are going to attack you, then you are afraid. You heard about that Socrates, three men in the cave narrated by Plato. That three men are looking into the cave and their own shadows are falling inside the cave. And they are afraid that these are monsters going to attack them. So they crouch together in fear that these monsters are going to attack us. As they crouch together, the shadows move also. So they say, see, there is moving. See, he's going to attack. Somebody, in the light of knowledge, in the light of the sun behind them, tells them, what are you doing? You don't have to be afraid. These are your own shadows. You are creating them. Because of the light behind you, you are creating your own shadows. Why are you afraid of your shadows? And these people say, this man is a co-conspirator with these monsters. He wants us to turn around so the monsters can attack us, so they never look back. He says, come, I can prove to you. Turn around. You can see the light. When you see the light, you will know how the light casts the shadow, and your shadow is coming there. Look at the light. They say, never look back. This man wants us to turn so these monsters can attack. He's also a monster. We do the same thing. The spiritual teachers, we do the same thing. They come and tell us that there is a light. There's a light behind our eyes. That light of consciousness is creating shadow plays outside. That what you see outside is being created merely like a shadow from the truth and the light which is inside of us. There is nothing real outside. The reality is all inside. It's cast outside. It's projected outside. It appears to be outside. It looks like it is outside. It is made to look like it is outside so that we can go through our karmic experience, so that we can go through the experience of free will, action and reaction, so that we can go through the experience for which the system is designed. It does not mean it becomes real. It is made to look real. If it is made to look real and you come to know it is only made to look real, how can you be afraid? But how will you find out? By turning around behind the eyes, looking back at the light within and seeing if the light is really there. And is that the light which is casting the shadows outside? That light is inside each one of us. It is not a special light that only enlightened people have. The enlightened person has seen the light. We all have the light. We have the same light. Nobody is bereft of that light. There is nobody born who doesn't have that light inside. It is that light of consciousness that makes the whole experience possible. That is why we see this world. Why are we so taken in by this drama which creates so much fear? Why have we been locked out? Well, we have been locked out to make the drama real. If it wasn't real, we wouldn't enjoy it. In our higher self, in our highest self, in our creative self, in our creator self, we would not enjoy whatever creation or drama we set up if it doesn't look real. How long can you sit and keep on daydreaming and saying, I am enjoying my drama? You're willing to pay $7, go and sit in a movie theater and look at the screen. That is as unreal as anything else. But you'd rather enjoy that than sit daydreaming and say, I am seeing a movie. That looks more real. You're willing to pay for it. We create this illusion of an unreal thing happening on a screen, and we are willing to enjoy it. But we don't enjoy it just because it is something happening on a screen. When we are watching a movie, we forget it is a movie. We cry. I see people with tears. I get tears myself. In fact, I've never cried except in a movie, my own life. They are so emotional. They're packed with so much. You identify so much with what's happening there. Now what's going to happen? Look at people in these horror movies. They are on tenterhooks. They're up on the heels. No, it's going to happen. Nothing is happening. It's just a shadow. They don't take it like a shadow. How can they take it like a shadow? If it was a shadow, who would pay for the ticket? Nobody would pay to go see a shadow. They go to see real drama. And yet they know it's not real. So the emotions, even fear comes into them. A very interesting experiment was done some years ago. A movie maker put up a horror movie on the screen and put the cameras there and made another movie of the audience. That was even more horrible than the horror movie. To see how much fear can be created. How much fear can be created in a live audience who are just seeing pictures on a screen.
that pictures on the screen can create so much fear in us. Emotion of fear is not being created by reality, but the illusion of reality. That we can create a make-believe and create fear. It's happening all the time. All our fears are based upon a make-believe. But the make-believe has to be very real for the purpose for which it has been designed. It's a great play. It's a stage play. You heard that. This whole world is just an act, a stage play. And we are all actors and audience at the same time on this play. If you go to Hollywood, if you go to Broadway in New York and you want to buy a ticket for a play, you can buy a ticket for one of the off-Broadway movies, maybe pay $10 or $15. But if you want to go on Broadway to see a real good play, you pay $45, $55 each. You pay a higher price for the play where the people act more real. If the people don't act too real, you pay less. The more an actor forgets he's an actor and starts acting the role, his character becomes more real than his original character outside of the stage, the more we are willing to pay to see him. In fact, we praise those plays most. We compliment those plays most where we say, this actor acted like it was real life. That he was really that. If our street barber, hairdresser goes and becomes a king on a stage, and if he is really acting like a king, we like it. But if in the middle of this royal stature that he's been given, he keeps on doing like this, we won't like the play. Just by bringing reality into illusion, he takes away our fear. Understand this, that we are paying to see illusion look like reality. Such is our situation here. To make this world look real, we have locked ourselves out sufficiently to start believing this is all real. Who did this? Who sets up all these realisms in the play? The director of the play. When the creator or director of a play, he sets it up, he makes sure it is real. And when the director and creator of a play is the creator himself, God himself, how will he take a chance and make the play less than perfect? Less than perfect in its reality. He has taken no chance. He has made each actor on the stage act the part with so much realism that we have, as actors, forgotten that we are actors. We've even forgotten that this is an act going on. Once upon a time, there was a very benevolent king, and his country was always at peace. So there was a big problem that he had an army set up for days of war and emergency, but there was no war because he was a good king. Nobody wanted to wage war against that country. So he wondered, what would happen to my army? They are completely out of practice. And I don't want to have a real war to give them practice. But if they are not kept alert, they lose their ability to be an efficient army. So what shall I do? So he decided that he will divide the army into two parts and make them red and blue, red army and blue army, and have mock fights so they at least have some practice. But then he was afraid that if people come to know there is a fight going on, their own peacefulness and happiness will be destroyed, that there is some violence going on in our country. So he decided to set up a big arena, a big compound with a wall around it. So they took up wooden planks and made a wall around it. And those wooden planks were supposed to cover up that area so nobody can see what is happening inside. And the mock battle started inside that big arena, and all was covered by wooden planks. But the wooden planks were not built so nicely like it is done these days. You can't see much out of these wooden planks, but they were just put together. They still left little chinks there. Between the planks, there were little chinks. When the army was divided into the Red Army and the Blue Army, and they began to have mock fights, the egos of the commanders got so strong, they thought it is real. They began to really kill each other. So the mock battle became real battle and went out of the control of the king. And the commanders decided what to do. And it looked so real. It was set up to be unreal as a show for practice. But it became real. And therefore there was a lot of gunfire and a lot of noise. And people came out to see what is happening here. But they were not allowed to see because there was a wall. So they tried to look for any little place from where they could watch. And they put their eyes on those chinks between the planks. And they saw that battle going on. And they got so tied up with this real battle going on. The mock battle became real for the actors, became real for the audience behind the chinks. They wouldn't go and have lunch at home. People came back, come on, it's time for lunch. They said, hold on, there's real battle going on. They would never leave those chinks. They would look all the time outside what's happening in that place. This is our story. This is a mock battle set up for settling our karma. It's not real. This is a stage set up so that we can have the experience of interrelationship or karma being settled. And we are sitting inside, just outside we are looking through the chinks of these eyes, of our senses. And we are so fascinated by the real violence taking place, the real relationships taking place, the real disappointment and pain taking place, the real suffering taking place. We are unwilling to leave this and go back home. It's our situation. It was set up for a different purpose. But we are so trapped into it, we are unwilling to go and see what's behind. Is our home behind? Shouldn't we visit home? We should go home and see what's happened. Come back and see the show. In our own leisure time, in our own free time, we should come and see. But we see all the time, we don't go home. This show that is going outside has been set up for a purpose. And the purpose is to experience something that Creator alone experiences. The Creator made so many things, but only one item of creation He made like Himself. Well, I'm calling Him Himself, but don't mind, it could be herself also. We just call God in a masculine sense. It doesn't mean that God is really only male. God includes all sexes. I used to say two, but now I say all, I don't know. This play, set up by God, is for the sake of those He has made in His own image. The only being He has created on the physical level of creation in His own image is the human being. The human being is the only being created almost identical like the Creator, and totally in His own image. What does that mean? It means if God had the creative power to decide what to create, He wanted to put the same thing, the creative power to decide what to create in a human being. But how could He do it? Either He could create or His puppet could create. How can both create? If He creates something and knows, I want to create this, I want that this thing should be created on the left side, how can He then create a human being with the same power of creation who should say, I want to create it on the right side? And God's creation will be upset. So He created a human being with the power to decide, with the power of free will, with the power of choice, created a human being with the power of choice and sat Himself inside that human being so that there is no divergence between what the human being decides and what God decides, so it remains the same decision. So that all free will should be within the free will of the Creator sat Himself inside the same human being and made the human being exercise choice. The human being began to think that it is individual choice taking place at this physical level. The feeling came that this was a choice that the individuated little being in a little trapped in a body was making. Whereas all that was being made by the ultimate Creator, who created this little being only in His own image. But there was no conflict between the two. Why did the human being think that the free will was his? Because he was unaware of who was sitting inside. This ignorance of the existence of the real Creator inside made the human being believe, I can decide what I want, I have free will. Of course, the human being was experiencing free will. It was actually given to him. Every human being experiences free will, free choice. But that choice is being directed from within by the same Creator who made that human being in His own image. When the human being discovers that there is a Creator inside, the Creator of all human beings and the Creator of the entire drama, the human being realizes there is no free will. The free will belongs to God. But so long as that ignorance persists, the human being believes, I have the free will. Human beings' free will is existing because of ignorance, lack of knowledge. God's free will is existing because of knowledge. He's doing it out of knowledge. Both exist, one because of knowledge, one because of ignorance, and both feel they have the free will. What a great copy. When we say God made man in his own image, we can never understand it except in terms of this quality of free will. There's nothing else common. And this essential thing that man can experience free will makes him so close to God, the closest to God, that it is said that the human form of life is the highest. It's higher than all the other gods or sub-creators that may exist anywhere. It's higher than the rulers of the heavens. They do not have that free will. It is higher than people living in the astral stage, in the causal stage, in the Akashic records, because they can see their past, present and future. How can they have free will? Human beings don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. They think we are deciding what will happen tomorrow, so they have free will. This ignorance is creating so much similarity between a human being and the Creator, that the human being, through that ignorance, has to decide what to do. That was a great show set up. The greatest show that could ever be imagined, ever be conceived, has been set up. And that show is that the creation should itself feel it is a creator. And because it is put into that creation, the same consciousness of God to create, the little human beings began to decide, I should do this or that. That is choice, free will. The moment choice came, morality came with it. The illusion of choice was a great step towards setting up a whole law of morality. The moment you give choice to a person, you set up morality at the same time, because how will you exercise choice? What is good, what is bad? You have to choose what is good. Morality follows from choice. Morality was a corollary to free will. If there was no free will, how could you be moral or immoral? If you are given no choice to decide what to do, if everything is decided by somebody else, you are given a script to read, how can you be responsible for good or bad? How can you be punished or rewarded? This whole responsibility of free will was transferred to the human being through ignorance, not knowing what is going to happen. And therefore, the moral law followed along with it. Because while making choices, the human being had to decide what is good, what is bad. In making those choices, good and bad, in a circumstance of time and space, in a creation of time and space, making a choice in time created a reaction in time. If the choice had been made in a timeless state, it didn't matter at all. When the choice was made at a level of creation where there was a time flowing, every choice made led to a reaction. And therefore, a complete cycle was set up. You make good choices, you get rewarded. You make bad choices, you are punished. If you are punished, then you have to come back for punishment. And when you have gone through punishment, you make other choices to get over punishment. You again come back for reward. Became almost an endless cycle of continuous existence in this time-space continuum. That's where we are trapped. This is the law of karma. Karma is all illusion. Free will is illusion. Morality is illusion. All this is a one single concept. It's not separate. You cannot say that free will exists but morality doesn't. It exists simultaneously. You cannot say free will and morality exist but karma does not exist. They exist together. But if the knowledge takes us out of this ignorance and we discover that we really have no free will, karma disappears, morality disappears at the same time. It's a single package. The package subsists upon its own features. So long as the human being felt, I make the decision, is bound by karma, bound by morality. That was a great show. Can you imagine? We are not talking of a little puppet show. We are talking of a show where the very essential nature of God, the very essence, the inner nature of God, the creative nature, the Creator Himself has come up into the show and put that into the human being. People fail to realize that is why we say that man was made in the same image as the Creator. This is the only quality man has which is exactly the same as of the Creator. Everything else is different. Where else is the common feature? Therefore, having been placed in such a situation that we could make our own choices and be punished and rewarded for them, we got very conscious of this power, but totally unconscious of what could happen if we use the power. We knew we can make a choice, but don't know what will happen if we make a choice. Fear was built right into it. The moment you know you have the power, but don't know what the impact of the power will be, you are afraid. Fear was a very basic thing. The ignorance of what reaction your decision can take led to fear. You are afraid. If you do this, what will happen? If you know, supposing you come to know, if you do this, this will happen. You'll never be afraid. If you get real knowledge that by certain actions, certain results follow, you can never be afraid. You will calculate, smile, laugh, beautifully decide your life, and never be afraid because you know what is going to happen. When you don't know, you are afraid. How was this achieved? What mechanics was used? To use a more local terminology, what kind of mechanics was used by the Creator to set up a system so perfect, so beautiful, so wonderful, and it's working so well forever? A system that has been set up for eternity and is working beautifully. What mechanics did he design for that? Very simple mechanics. The mechanics was that in the consciousness that God put into the human being, he added around it an apparatus, a computer-like apparatus that worked like a computer, and it's called the human mind. The human mind was attached as a complement, as a device for the human being to use like a computer. It could store things in memory, it could be retrieved, it could do logical processing. It had all the logic. It could say, it could argue logically, it could infer from data put into it. Anything that you find in a modern computer is there in the human mind, which is nothing but an excellent computer. The best computer you can design would be the human mind. But it is no more than a computer. It's not a living thing. The living thing is the same replica of the Creator, the soul, consciousness, which is using the computer and storing data into it, storing its choices into it, storing the effects of it. When this computer was put into it, the computer functioned in a reckless speed, high-speed computer. It worked all the time to give us information. But the computer could not decide what is going to happen. It made many guesses. All the options, the millions of options possible. The human mind began to think this can happen, that can happen. Everything could happen. In free will situation, anything can happen. So the computer worked out many possibilities, options. As the computer, the human mind, through the thought process, the process put into it was a thought, thinking. As the thinking developed in the human mind, the thinking created immense possibilities. Good, bad, one that didn't appeal to you, some that appealed to you, and the consciousness, using the computer, began to take decisions, hoping it'll be one of these options, always afraid what result there will be. When the human consciousness sitting in this mind computer, working through that machine, could not be sure what was going to happen, a new situation came called doubt. An experience came into the consciousness, the psyche of the human being, called doubt. You are doubtful, not sure, lack of certainty. This uncertainty and doubt, unsureness, that crept in. Because you could not be sure what will be the effect. You tried many choices, always unsure. So the whole human life became a life of doubt and uncertainty. And the more uncertain it became, the more fear crept in. Every time you have doubt, you have fear. Because doubt means lack of knowledge. You will see that the basic premise still remains the same, that fear is the result of lack of knowledge. Fear is of the unknown. Fear is because we don't know. Doubt means we don't know. We are not sure. This particular feature of the human situation trapped in this physical world, where doubt was the basic thing that was growing all around, kept us away from our home forever. If we did not have doubt, we would not be trapped here forever and never be able to see our own home. But the doubt that we had and the fear that it generated made us doubt even about the very possibility of going back home. Doubt became a habit. Doubt became a way of life. We are leading our lives in this world with doubt as a way of life. Some of the casualties of doubt are so terrible, they're tragic. One of the most tragic consequences of this habit of doubt was that love, true love, which was the essential nature of consciousness and of the spirit and of the creator and of the soul, the essential nature of love which was there in the spirit, in the creator, in our soul, in our consciousness, that was the first casualty of doubt. And doubt even killed that love in us. If we had love, if we experienced love with human beings in our life, we are doubtful. Is it real? Are you sure? We destroyed every relationship because of this doubt. Love was so pure, it was not even an emotion. Love was the purest form of consciousness. Love was the only link between the creator and the creation. Love was the only thing that separated the soul from the creator. Love was the only thing that kept a relationship between the soul and its creator, and we destroyed that because of our doubts. We're doubting everything. Had we not doubted love, we would be up in heaven right now. We would make this life heaven. We would see the whole of creation would become heaven. Think of this. If there is a person who has no doubt and is full of love, and the love is beyond doubt, won't that person be living in heaven even here? Do you realize this is heaven for such a person? We don't have to go to some place to go to hell. We make it here. We don't have to go somewhere else to go to heaven. It is here. Hell is being created by our doubts. Hell is being created by our own mind. And heaven is created by our own soul. If we let the mind get away and not interfere, not create doubts with the purity of our own love that exists automatically. Love is more permanent than anything else. This body, this physical body, is very short-lived. We have seen it being born, we have seen it grow, we have seen it die. Every day people are born and every day they die. We see with our own eyes. If they are dying, how can we live forever? We don't calculate we are going to die. We make a lot of plans. Any moment we can go away. Any moment this body can die. And it will die, definitely. This is already dying. The human body starts dying when it's born. The moment it's born, you can predict it's dying. It's never survived. The only question is how long it will take to die. We are in a process of dying all the time. What are we talking about this body which is dying? To give so much attention to the body is useless because it is dying. And it will die very soon. The sensory system, the astral body, the finer bodies will survive. They may live 1,000 years, 2,000 years in physical time. But even they will die. The senses also die. The sensory astral bodies die. They have a birth and death. What about the mind, that great computer? It can live millions of years. But even that will die. There's no permanent mind at all. It was created and will die. Whatever has a beginning will die. The body will die, senses will die, astral bodies will die, causal body will die, mind will die. What will not die? The soul, which is the power of consciousness experiencing all these bodies. That is love. The only essential ingredient in that soul is love. So love is the highest thing that never dies. And yet sitting in these little temporary bodies, we are killing it here. The one thing that survives everything is the greatest casualty of our tragic life on this earth planet, on this physical planet. We have reached this state because we got into this trap of overusing our mind. We were given a computer, and instead of using it for our purpose, we could have made very good use of the computer. The mind can be an excellent computer, excellent slave, excellent servant. You can make real good use of it if you remain in control. But if you let the mind control you, it goes haywire. You know the story of Aladdin? It's become a movie now, but it's a different movie. It's not the story I am telling. The story I heard as a child was a little different. The story I heard was that Aladdin was a little boy who found a lamp, and when he rubbed the lamp, a big genie appeared. And the genie was so big and so frightening, the little boy was frightened. And he said, "Go away." But genie said, "I am your slave, master, command what I shall do." The little boy didn't understand how such a big genie could be his slave, but he held the lamp. So the genie was his slave. So he commanded the genie to go and make a big house. just to test him out. And the genie, in a few moments, made a big house and came back. Said, command what I shall do now. The little boy said, you are so quick and so efficient. Go and make a long bridge. He wanted to get rid of the genie somehow. But the genie would come back in a few minutes. The bridge is ready. So every task that the boy gave to the genie, genie did since so fast that ultimately there was no more commands to give. And the boy said, do what you like. And the genie said, come on then. So then the genie began to give command. Because the boy would give no commands. He didn't know what to say. So genie began to tell him what to do. And made the life of that boy miserable. It's our story. We were given a great genie, powerful mind. Instead of telling the mind what to do, because the mind is so efficient, we sit and let the mind decide for us. The thoughts are deciding our life. We are allowing our thoughts to dictate to us what we should be doing. Instead of telling the thoughts what they are supposed to be doing. Instead of using our mind, we are being used by the mind. Instead of leading our mind what to do, the mind is leading us what to do. What a sad state. We are in the same sad state like that Aladdin boy. But Aladdin was lucky because he had a friend who knew the situation. So when that friend came and said, Aladdin, you used to be such a happy-go-lucky fellow. What's happened to you? He said, I don't know. I found this great genie. He's so powerful, so efficient, does things so fast. I have run out of commands. I don't know what order to give him now. He said, that is no problem. I'll tell you. I'll give you a little tip that will help you. He took Aladdin aside and he said, look, next time the genie says, what shall we do? Tell him to go and bring a large pole, a wooden pole from the forest. When he brings a pole, tell the genie, dig it in this room. Dig it right here in the center. And he says, what is the next command? Say, genie, till I give you another command, go up and down this pole. Keep him up and down on the pole. When you need him, take him off. Come off the pole, genie, do this work. When he is finished, genie, go up and down this pole. So Aladdin found a good answer. This is our story too. When masters who are enlightened know our situation, come into our life, they tell us, this mind is very powerful, but there is a way to control it. And that is, put them on repetition of words, on mantra. Put it on simran, on repetition, on meditation. Dig a little pole of words, of mantra, behind your eyes. Close your eyes, put the mind to repeat that. Let the mind keep on repeating. When you want to use the mind, take it off. Use it. After that, say, go back to repetition. You'll have no problem. There are masters who are solving the problem for us, like that friend solved the problem for Aladdin. So this is just a story to tell you the devastating power of an excellent machine given to us. If you use this machine well, there is nothing more efficient than this. If you allow the machine to run your life, you are in terrible misery. If you let your mind decide what should be done, you are in terrible misery. If you tell the mind what should be done, you are in heaven right here. How shall we distinguish between ourselves and the mind? Who is deciding who? We don't know about it because when we go inside our head, it looks at the same thing. We have got so used to identifying ourselves with these machines and covers around ourselves, we don't even know who is who. That's why we lost knowledge of our own self. This body is a cover. It's not ourself. From tomorrow, start treating this body as a cover. Half your problems will disappear. You won't say, I am sick. When you say, I am sick, you get sick right up to the soul. When you say, my body is sick, at least the rest of it is okay. It's simply shift of attitude. You can just shift your attitude and your perception. You can shift your perception. What is happening to the body? Let me look at it. You are sitting inside the body. You are watching the body. Go inside and watch it. Look at it. Treat it. Take care of it. But don't become it. Why we are suffering is that because we have become the body. Okay? If the body is not you, it is a big help. What about the senses? Well, we think these eyes are me. What I am looking is me. Touching is me. All the sensory perception is me. No, they are only senses. You are using them. If something is wrong with the senses, okay, I'll set it right. But you are not the senses. Half your problems disappear there. But then the biggest problem is, we still identify ourselves with the mind. I am thinking like that. I think I'll do that. That's the biggest problem. That's where we are suffering. Why can't we say, my mind is thinking like that? Let me see how I can make the mind think something else. Your whole life will change. Do you know by making these three changes, your life can change from this instant onwards? That you are the soul, the spirit, the consciousness that is using these three functions, the body, senses and mind. And if you start using them and not letting them use you, your whole life changes. When you say, I want to use my mind, you give direction to the mind what to do. Now, what is the difference between the experience you are having through the mind and your own spiritual or conscious experience from the soul? Difference is very obvious. The mind can function only in this linear time-space continuum. The mind does not function anywhere else. Every thought must have a duration. Every thought must have a cause and effect relationship. You cannot think without it. And yet the soul does not require any time or space. That sudden impact of joy and beauty and that smile that comes up can never come to the mind, only to the soul. Here are these features, intuition, love, joy, beauty, that the soul alone is experiencing. You cannot make it up by thinking about it. And then there are thoughts going on in time, space, sequence, cause and effect, which is the mind playing. The two are totally different. One is operating in time and space, the other is operating outside of time and space. A straight line between the two. You can never have any doubt which is which. But understand who the self is. If you go within and watch these things happening, watch your mind at work, you will know who you are. I'll give you a more simple formula. When you go within, a more simple formula to find out where is your soul and where is your mind. The one that speaks in your head is the mind. The one that listens is the soul. What other definition do you want? So you can always know who you are. You are the listener. If you can sit behind the eyes and see the mind at work through his speaking, you can separate yourself and know who you are. When you come to know who you are, you are not bothered by the sicknesses of the mind and the body and the senses. You get happiness and you deal with the problem like you deal with external problems. You don't say, it's my problem, I am suffering. You know who is suffering and how you can help it. You can help your body, you can help your senses, you can help your mind by sitting in control. But if you let them, sick mind and sick body and sick senses, take over, you become sick also along with them. You get the same experiences if you identify with the mind. The mental experience becomes your experience if you identify yourself with the mind and think you are the mind. The sensory experience becomes your experience when you identify with the senses. And these body's experiences become your experiences when you identify with the body. It is our identification. But why do we identify so quickly? The reason is we are made of that stuff called love. And love means identification. What is love after all? When you say somebody loves somebody, it's identification with that object of love. When the lover is identifying with the beloved, it's called love. The lover does not separate himself from the beloved, that's called love. Love is a process of identification. So consciousness is automatically inclined towards love and inclines to identification. The only pity is it identified itself with the mind. Should have identified itself with the soul, with the higher soul, with its own creator. Instead of identifying with the truth, it identified with the illusion and with the mind. What are we going to do in this workshop to overcome fear, to get to know your own self? I make a very bold statement, whoever comes to know the soul and oneself will be free from fear, can live a fearless life, totally fearless. And to know the soul is to know yourself. To know yourself is not to identify yourself with the body, the senses or the mind. And to do that, go within, see these covers around you as if they are separate from you. And see where you are sitting inside, operating this or these machines, where you are inside in your consciousness, operating the machine of your body, operating the machine of your senses, and operating the machine of your mind. Go in and see these machines working, and you will know who you are, and your power and your knowledge will dispel all fear. But how do we go in? We go in by withdrawing our attention. We have a good way of going anywhere. You know how we go somewhere? We go with our attention. Supposing you are all here now, and I say there is something happening in that next room. Can you go there? You can immediately imagine you are there with your attention. Attention is a great thing. Consciousness is a very general thing. It is creating the whole experience. Within consciousness, you are aware only of something instantly, which is in front of you. Within awareness, you have a little probe that can move. That's attention. So consciousness is a big thing that includes everything created, ever. Awareness is what we are immediately aware of in consciousness. And attention is where we are paying attention within that limited awareness. But attention can be moved. Awareness and consciousness cannot be moved. If you have certain consciousness, you have it. If you are aware of something, you are aware. You can do nothing about it. But attention you can move. You can decide to attend to it or not to attend to it. You go to hear an orchestra, a music, and you want to hear all the drums are playing, the other instruments are playing. You put your attention on the drums become louder. They aren't actually becoming louder. You're just putting your attention. By putting your attention on one instrument, you are able to block the experience, the sensory experience of other instruments. Which means that attention is a very powerful tool to move your awareness. Attention is the only secret of meditation. Attention is what can lead you where you want to go. Attention can lead you to your own self. But we are used to throwing our attention outside to various things. By desires and attachments, we are constantly putting our attention on this external world. Whatever we think of, that pulls the attention there. We think of our families, our children, our businesses, our parents, our brothers, sisters, our friends, the disappointed ones and the ones who disappointed us and so on. And every time we think of it, our attention goes there. We sit here listening and our attention is roaming all around the world. We sit in meditation and the attention roams everywhere, is all scattered. Our own attachments and our own experiences have scattered our attention all over. How do we bring it back? By a process which the mystics and masters have taught us. A beautiful natural process of withdrawal of attention. Withdraw your attention where? To your own self. Where is your self? Wherever it's coming out from. Attention cannot come out from anywhere except yourself. Therefore, if you withdraw your attention to its source, you are withdrawing your attention to yourself. Now, if you close your eyes and wonder, where are all these thoughts coming from? Where are all my ideas coming from? Where are my words coming from? Where is my voice coming from? Where am I listening to somebody? Where is my seat of consciousness? If you contemplate that with your eyes closed, it doesn't take too long to discover that all this is happening in the center of the brain. That you are doing this from behind the eyes. If you examine yourself, you'll find, to be more precise, if these two fingertips are the eyes, eyeballs, you place them like this, then where these two fingers meet is precisely the kind of spot behind the eyes where our consciousness is operating from. If we know so well where we are, why not put our attention there? Why not put our attention in the center of the head, knowing that is where we are operating from? That's where we're throwing the attention out from. Why not withdraw it and put it back there? We don't know how to withdraw attention. Nobody ever taught us. Everybody, our parents, our school teachers, our friends, our relationships, everybody we met in this world taught us how to throw attention out. Even yoga teachers, focus your attention on this thing. When you focus attention, you throw it out. Every focusing of attention we ever did in our life on anything was to throw attention out. Nobody taught us that you put attention back. So we are unused to it. These masters have come and told us that the secret is withdrawal of attention. Withdraw it to yourself, which is not the same thing as focusing somewhere. Whenever you focus attention, however close you may focus to yourself, it is still outside of yourself. If you want to reach your own self, you must not focus attention on anything, but withdraw it to yourself. So how do we withdraw attention? Well, we use the same method that I just suggested for you. If you want to feel you are in that room, imagine you are in that room. Your attention goes there. If you want to withdraw attention to the center of your head, imagine you are in the center of the head. The longer you can imagine, the more your attention will be withdrawn there. And if there is any light there, if there's any experience there, you'll get it. You want to try? Let's do it. Why talk about it? Let's do it. Try. Sit in a relaxed position. Take this body to be a mansion, a house. Don't take it to be yourself. Treat this body as it is a house which has got several stories, several floors. And you, the eyes are the sixth floor. This body, sixth floor is at the eyes. The other floors are below. The higher seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth, 12th floor are above this. But the sixth floor is here. We don't have to go down into the chakras, into the emotional centers. You don't have to, unless you are curious and want to make a little trip for a short while and come back. We are already here. When a human being is awake, a human being, consciousness is already at the sixth floor. It's only by going into a descent into so-called suggestive dream, into so-called yoga, into so-called tranquilized state, into so-called samadhi that you go down. You don't have to. If you want to see the truth, remain awake and be more awake. If you want to have relaxation, go down. It's up to you. You can try both, but you can also relax with the truth inside. Or you can relax by losing some of the wakefulness and going to another experience in the lower chakras. I recommend you stay awake and find out who you are. After finding out, do what you like, go anywhere you like. But don't go without first knowing who you are. To know who you are, stay at the eye level. The whole head, this whole body, this is a great body. Don't forget, this is the temple of the living God. It is a truth. This human body is the best temple, best church you can ever visit. There's none created like this. You are entering the very highest church and the highest temple and the highest house of God ever created and ever made now. And that's what you carry with you all the time. In this house of God, God is living right in the head. He's inside. So are you. But you never meet. You never meet each other. You're not even neighbors. You are living in the same house. You don't meet each other. That's the irony of creation. First of all, you have to meet yourself. Know who you are. Not the misidentification with the body and with the senses and the mind. Behind the eyes, set up a floor. Set up a nice floor. Now, I'm giving you these tips because of my experience with past workshops. That the tendency to go down is very strong in all of us. It's natural. Every night we go down. Every night when we go to sleep, we lower this focal point of consciousness down below to the tip of the nose and below to the mouth, to the throat. Every night. When we wake up, we take it up again, and when it comes to the eye level, we wake up. You can try it out. Every night you do it. Tonight when you're going to sleep, when you're half asleep, try to touch your eyes. You touch your nose. And you still think you're touching your eyes. Which means what you think is the level of your eyes itself is shifting down. It shifts every night. At wakeful state, you are at the level of the eyes. So when you close your eyes, you are aware that these eyes are right in front of you. When you close your eyes, your nirth, your power of seeing, the power of seeing which is nirth, that power of seeing stays behind the eyes. And although you are not using these eyes at all, still your imaginative power of seeing is still there. It doesn't shift. So the imaginative power of seeing, which is the real power of seeing? The eyes are the organs. The power of seeing, which can see even in a dream, which can see even in imagination, which can see even when you die, it can see when the body is destroyed. That power of seeing remains at this level. That's the important thing. That level is so important. It's the wakeful level. It's the physical wakeful level. When you close your eyes, stay at that same level. Don't go to sleep. That's why I said make a nice floor here. Strong. Cement. Put some iron into it if you want to. After your experiences, you can decide what to do. But don't go below this so that you don't go to sleep. If you remain awake and still withdraw your attention, you will see the light within. You will see what else is there. All the goodies you can ever think of, all the treasures of this creation are all sitting inside us. In fact, it is that stuff inside which is creating this drama outside. So you are going to have access to some truth. Treat this body like a house. Believe you are at the eye level. Imagine you are sitting in the center of the head. Imagine. Imagine again and again. If your thoughts go away that no, you are sitting on the chair, again pull it up that no, you are sitting behind the eyes. If the imagination takes you somewhere else, you remember some things. The mind will fight frantically, I can tell you now only. This is one exercise where the mind fights. Every other exercise, the mind cooperates. You try to go to the lower chakra, mind will cooperate with you. You try to stay here, it will fight with you. You can try it out, now only. The mind fights. It's fighting for its own survival. It's fighting to show, no, this is you and me are the same. And you are trying to find out what's going on. So don't be taken in by the mind's games. Stay in the center of the head. Stay where you are. I'm not saying go somewhere. Go where you are. That means don't go anywhere. We are going all the time with our attention. Stop going. Just stay behind the eyes from where all these thoughts are emerging anyway. Imagine you are there. Imagine you are sitting on a nice floor. You can take a chair. Take a nice chair to sit on. Do you prefer a chair or you want to sit on a mat? How many of you would like a chair? Please raise your hands. Nice chair. Okay, I can tell you it's free. You can choose the best. How many of you would like to sit on a floor with a mat on it? Okay, choose the best and make a nice place. Imagine that place is already made up and you are sitting in the way in which you are most comfortable. In the physical body, which is now your house, also make it very comfortable here. Don't lie down, don't go to sleep. Make it upright so you don't go to sleep. But don't make such a strange posture that your attention is constantly in that posture. Make it normal, natural. And then make a natural self of your own imaginative being on the floor, on the chair, behind the eyes. Please close your eyes and begin. Imagine you are there, behind the eyes. Can you see that the eyeballs are in front of you? Can you see that the ears are on either side of you? Your head and your hair are above you. Your throat is below you. Can you really feel you are in the center? Don't move from there. Stay in the center. Don't go down and don't go up. Just stay in the center. Withdraw, withdraw behind the eyes, not in front. Not in the eyes, behind the eyes. Further back. Further back. In the head. See how you are sitting. Watch yourself sitting on the floor, on the chair. Feel how you feel sitting there. Move around inside, find the right spot and sit down there. Level behind the eyes, nowhere else. Stay behind the eyes. No strain, don't put strain on your head, not on the eyes. We are not talking of physical eyes at all. Imagination, stay with your imaginative self. No stress on the physical head. Relax. Don't be tense. Smile. Smile. Enjoy sitting there. It's not a punishment. It's rejoicing. Sit and relax. Enjoy. Smile. Feel good that you found the place. Explore the center. Behind the eyes. Don't come out. Stay behind. No thoughts. Don't think of anything except what the place is like. Look around and see the place. Don't think of anything else. Stay there. Behind the eyes. Relax. Don't go to sleep. Keep awake. Keep awake there. Explore. Look around if you want to, but don't go to sleep. Stay in the center. Sit relaxed, absolutely relaxed. With a smile on your face and seeing what's going on. Who are you? What are you doing? What are you doing sitting there? Explore your own position behind the eyes. Don't move out. Let any pictures and images come in front of you. Let them come and go. What comes in front, treat it like a television screen. Watch it and let it go. Don't move forward. Let those patterns of color and light and black and white, whatever comes in front, let them move. Let them go from one side to another. Don't follow them. Stay back in the center. Don't think of anything else but the center. stay awake behind the eyes. Don't think of anything else. No thoughts. If you want to think of what is around you. Where are you sitting? Where are you? Where are your eyes? Where is your head? Think of the space inside, not outside. Give up all other thoughts, only the space inside, the center. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Open your eyes and look this side. Open your eyes, look this side. Did you get some feel of the center? Anybody got a feel of the center? Please raise your hands. Thank you. Any questions about this little exercise we did? Yes.
Yes, the mind, when you try to stabilize yourself there, the mind comes from behind. It's normal.
Any other question?
Let's say we took 10 people and they became self-realized. If this happened for the first time for them, where would they be in consciousness? Would they all be in the same level?
Yes.
That would be the highest level?
That'll be one. They'll find out that they're just looking like 10.
Yeah.
They aren't. They are not 10. They were never 10.
Okay. But then they wouldn't be in different levels of the higher planes. They would all be at that one
yes.
spot, right?
Ultimately, there's only one spot.
Yeah, okay.
And only one consciousness.
Yeah.
And only one truth, only one being. That's the truth. We are moving in that direction. Yes, any other question or comment? Yes. It's good. When the bells come, hear them. But hear them by staying where you were.
It was like three different tones and that was it.
Yes. Which one was more melodious, more beautiful out of the three? The little tingling ones or the big one?
It would seem like little ones.
Okay, you listen to them next time.
Okay.
Okay? Any other question or comment? Yes.
In my case, I seem to be on a plane of light that just held right there, but there were kind of like solid Salvador Dali paintings, except far more gentle little objects out there, but I tried to stay focused here. But you reminded me of another experience I had, not today. When the physical sensations of this body cease, and the emotions quit pulling us in all directions, and the mind quits solving problems, how is it that the one sensation, at least the one I did not lose, was my oral sense? I could still hear of events going on around, but I had no consciousness of the rest of the physical body.
The oral sense, the sense of hearing, persists into higher levels also. It's the one that will persist more than other senses. It's the highest sense, in fact. Yes.
Yes.
When I did it, my eyes felt like they were so straining. I kept on trying to... My eyes, I think, were rolling back, and it was bothering me, and I kept on trying to be there and be looking out through them rather than... Is it just practice so that your eyes aren't...
Yes. Stretch your hand like this in front of you now. Don't look at the hand. Imagine you are there. Can you imagine? Mm-hmm. Is any strain on the eyes?
No.
Why not? This is pure imagination. You're not trying to use these eyes. But when you imagine there, you're still trying to use these eyes.
Yeah.
Look at it again. Put your hand on the side now. Imagine you are there. It's pure imagination taking you there. No strain on the eyes. Try that imagination next time. Don't use these eyes at all. Ignore them, just like you ignore them now. When I said now, imagine, you had no problem. Because you used pure imagination. Earlier, you were trying to use these physical eyes. Don't use these eyes at all. Ignore them. They're just a body. Imagine you are there and don't put any strain. Don't try to see anything. When you imagine you are somewhere, you're not trying to see anything. When you imagine you are on the hand, you did not try to see anything. You just imagine you were there. That attention went there. Same way, but when you want to imagine you are behind, you're trying to see what's there. You don't have to use the power of these eyes to see. So relax. First of all, take all the strain off the head and the eyes, and then imagine you are there in the center. Some strain will come because we are used to it.
But if you try in the same way like you did now, it will disappear. Take it in an imaginary way, right? Any other question? No question?
Yes.
Ishwar, how come some people get experiences really, really fast and other people get them really slow?
Depends upon how much baggage we are carrying. Some of us carry so much baggage we move slow. Others are light and they run.
What if you just want to dump your baggage and...
That's what we are trying to do. That's exactly the exercise we are doing to dump our baggage. We are carrying needless baggage.
Is it possible when you meet your master that he can help you dump your baggage?
Yeah. If he's in a good mood, he can pick up a he can pick up a few bags. Yeah. Yes.
You say people want to meditate because they're in fear or they're anxious or whatever. And so to get to this spot, to learn or to be ready to listen, how do you do that? Do you pray and then slow yourself down? Or you know what I mean? If you're real anxious or you say, oh, I need to meditate and get in touch. What do you do to get to that from a crazy state to a place to get ready to listen?
The question is, what do you do if you are anxious and you are concerned and you want to calm down, you are very full of anxiety? Do you pray or do you meditate? What do you do? That's the question, right? The answer is that we are practicing something in advance of that situation. We are practicing something so that that anxiety does not come. We are not practicing to overcome a particular anxiety. This is a prophylactic medicine. It's a medicine that you take beforehand so you don't get that anxiety. If you're already anxious, then you have to use a different machine, different method. So what we are now practicing is to know something about ourselves that will remove all anxieties forever. So this should be practiced not because we wait for a problem to come, but this is in advance of any problem, so the problems are taken care of. If you are really under great stress and anxiety, you cannot really meditate. You have a problem, you know that. That's why you ask this question. When you are already under heavy stress and you say, let me meditate now. You say, that's the stress is there on you. You're trying to meditate. What we are practicing here is one of such relaxed atmosphere, such natural state. We are not in that state already. So we have to tackle that problem separately. The problem that has created the anxiety has to be taken care of. Then you'll be ready to meditate. How do we take care of a problem? You remember I gave a formula long ago. It was given by a nice man to me, how to deal with problems. The real anxiety comes not because of a problem, but because we don't want to face the problem. The real anxieties in our life are because we want to skirt around problems. The problem is there, we want to find some way how we can escape from it. Go around it. Somehow find some more time for it. See if we can solve it by some passage of time hiding behind some pillar. The problem will go away. Problems have never gone away. We come out, they are still there. Therefore, the answer for solving a problem is, when a problem comes, first greet it. Then meet it, then beat it. Take it squarely in front. Greet it. Come on, problem, I want to meet you. I don't want to run away from it. Meet it, understand it, and beat it to the best of your ability. You'll be better off. Anxiety will go. Then meditate. Right? Okay, I came here because this may be applicable to some other people also. Yes. Yes, George.
All your lectures have always suggested to me that there's a strange message. One is that everything is all right, but everything is all wrong. And that what is all wrong is that God, in a way, has intended us to play the game in one way. And we seem to systematically, almost all of us, get off the track, and now it's like a remedy is being offered. Somebody, the master comes in and says, no, you're not playing the game right. And then when you talk to the master, he says, but on the other hand, there's no, not to worry, because everybody's going to get there eventually. And over the years, I've occasionally keep wondering, and now I thought of it, can you model some kind of a, what would it be like if we were playing this game the way it was intended?
That's a good question coming from an artist. That's a very good question George has asked me. He's heard many talks of mine. He has been listening to me for years now. So he knows all my philosophy inside out. So he's come to this conclusion that I'm giving two simultaneous messages. One, that everything is all right because it's God creation and he planned it in a certain way. Second message is everything is wrong because we are not playing according to his rules. And this creates a great conflict. We are not playing according to his rules and he set it up. He put us in a position that we can't play properly. Then he comes back in the form of masters and teachers and gurus to tell us, oh, there is a way out. You can still play the game correctly. And why don't you do this? It's a very messy situation which has been created right from beginning till now. He wants to know what would be the situation, what would be the actual life of people if they were playing according to the rules in the first place and there was no mess around. Isn't that the question? Okay. The answer is, a bulk of us are still in that state playing according to rules. They are not here. Overwhelming majority of those souls created the creation of the Lord is playing according to rules and enjoying themselves. But they are not here. They are not attending my workshop. We want to go and see how they are doing it. The masters are suggesting a way we can go and see how they are doing. They are there. They are many more than us, several times more. And they are playing according to the rules. And they have been playing for eternity. You can go and see them. So the problem is a very limited one. We are only in a very small segment of the problem area. And we are tackling the problem only in the problem area, which is very small, thank God. It's not such a big thing that everybody has been put in distress. Secondly, even in this problem area where we are caught up, there's one good thing, that whatever our situation might be, we never lose our link with that truth, with God, with the Creator, with the ultimate reality. We never lose that link because of our consciousness, because of our self, the self, the feeling that the self, that some conscious being existing, that feeling is the link with our home. It's never lost. We have never locked ourselves out of reality forever. That would be tragedy. Ultimate tragedy would be if God created something and locked himself out forever. He didn't do that. He never took that risk. He kept the key with him, so he can go back and open the door and get in. The key is this stream of consciousness, which is audible, can be heard. And the hearing power goes beyond, right into our house. We can hear. We can hear the bells. We can hear the sounds. And by listening to the sounds alone, we can go right to the top to our house. And great power is there all the time with each one of us. This music, this sound inside, is going on all the time in each one of us, 24 hours. We may sleep, that sound never sleeps. That sound is the connection. That sound is the word. That sound is the nard. That sound is the shabad. That sound is the Holy Ghost. That sound is the truth. That sound is the link between us and the Creator at all times and has never been broken. That's the good thing. It's always been there. All we have to do is to be in the right spot. When we go to the third eye center behind the eyes, when we go to the 10th door, these 9 doors, the 9 apertures on the body take us out. The 10th door behind the eyes takes us in. When we reach the center of the 10th door, which I was trying to lead you to, we'll find that sound and hear it. When you can hear the sound, if you can merely hear the sound and put your attention on the sound, you need nothing else, but that is the way directly to your own home. The sound is so important. The sound is the link and never leaves us. That sound is what is creating this whole experience. The sound is the sound of consciousness itself. So that's a great royal road that has been kept right in sight to perform our spiritual journey to the highest level of consciousness. So while I understand, George, your concern, but I am happy that it's a very limited, the disease is very controlled and limited, and we have a remedy for that too. Let's hope the people will take the medicine. Because some people take the medicine for their sickness and they keep it on the shelf in their house. Then the medicine doesn't do any good. The masters come and they give us certain medicine, they give us a method, they tell us what to do, we keep it on a shelf. We don't practice. Then we don't get the results. This is a path of practice, doing it, not reading about it. So if we take the medicine, we'll get well. If we practice what the masters teach us, we will get the benefit.
So are you suggesting that the Homo sapien is a manifestation of the spirit or soul making the air? I mean, like life on Earth is like purgatory or a hell. Spirits or souls that have made an air, and that may be on other planets or on other levels. Maybe the healthier soul takes on a different shape or a different...
Yes. There are many kinds of spaces. This is a great space of combination of experiences. This is the best place where there's a combination of hell and heaven. Other places are more tilted towards one or the other. There are many other places of residence for the soul and the mind and the astral systems, but they are more tilted towards either heaven or hell. Either you are rejoicing and blissful and having a good time for the good deeds you did, or you are being punished and are constantly under torture. This is a good place where there is a combination of the two. We have heaven and hell together here. We make it into hell ourselves with our own mind, we make it into heaven with our own mind, and we live in hell and heaven all the time, up and down all the time. Every person who is sitting here, every person on this planet has this up and down. This is a strange kind of planet. But this is a good planet because this is where free will is most effective, looks most real. The more ups and downs you have, the more free will looks real. And that's why if you free will looks real, the seeking also looks real and the seeking becomes real. Yes.
In a kind of follow-up on what you're just saying, when Zen came to Japan, the samurai using it became aware that they were indestructible and therefore they could go into battle fearlessly. If I am a potter and I have this same awareness and I work with clay, the pot and I become one. When with that awareness you also become aware that making this pot is of no great consequence.
True.
But on the other hand, without that awareness, you simply create a vessel. With the awareness, you may create a work of art.
That's right.
So I guess what I'm trying to understand is, if it isn't important, in Zen the idea is you do it as if it were. The point, or the question I guess is, why do it?
Because you can't help it. The Zen understood that doing is not something that is in your control. There is a certain state in which we are caught, where we have to do. Supposing you say, I don't want to do, that's also doing. We are trapped in a state of decision making, which is doing. If you have to do, what do? That's how they answered that question. There is no way we can get out of this situation. We don't want to do, that's also a decision. Somebody says, I want to get in a situation, I don't want to decide anything. That's the first decision he has taken. We are trapped. This free will is not a great thing we have got, it's a trap. We are trapped by this illusion of free will where we cannot get out of this situation that we need not decide. Oh, that's a decision itself. We are constantly deciding. We cannot get out of it. It's a big trap of Zen found a method. They found a method what to do. If we have to do, we do. What do? We do this. Same situation is here. Clear? Okay. Yes.
I knew a fellow who died of old age, but before he died, he told one of his children, even though he had a wife and about 7 children, he had been quite a rake and he did a lot of running around on his wife and that sort of thing. And I don't think he was a drinker or anything, but that's what he did. And he was very frightened of dying because of what he thought his punishment would be. And It was based strictly upon his religious upbringing. But I would think a lot of people would have anxiety, even though they believe in life after death and that the soul is immortal and it's going to go on. But at the same time, if people understand karma and that you can die and then go into some of the lower worlds, and that is not necessarily a happy state, that in itself then could bring a lot of anxiety on. And how do you get around that? I mean, how do people overcome that fear?
That person who, before dying, was afraid what will happen to him because of what he did, was justified in his fear because he did not know what is going to happen. These people who know about the law of karma, that whatever we are doing, we'll have to pay for it in some form, are afraid and anxious because they don't know what will happen to them. Both these cases illustrate that the anxiety and fear is coming from not knowing what will happen to them. Not knowing what is going to happen to them, not knowing what will happen to them. They are afraid something will happen, but they don't know what. That's why they are anxious. They know there is life after death, but they don't know what it will be like. So they are afraid and anxious. What is the solution? Ultimate solution is to get into a state where you don't have to be born again and again. Isn't that the ultimate solution? Why find temporary solutions? Find the ultimate solution. And that's what the masters are suggesting. The perfect living masters don't come here to tell you, make your lives better and get a better life in future. Don't make your life so hellish, make it heavenly. They don't come to say that. Whether it's hell or heaven, it's the same prison. It's the same jail, the same trap. They come and tell us, rise to a level above the level of your mind. All this rebirth and reincarnation and karma is up to the mind. Go above it. There is no karma. There is no rebirth. Relax and enjoy there. That's the solution. Yes?
What you have just said, go above the mind. I think of my mind sitting in this cavity here. And years ago, I was taught to go from the center to the top of the head. I was told, take your child to the mountaintop and say the name of God. Now, that's above the mind. You're saying hold it in the center of the head. Would you distinguish between the two?
Yes. This physical body, even up to the top of the head, is only physical. If you go through your attention in the physical body up to the top of the head, it is still physical. You've gone nowhere. If you withdraw your attention behind the eyes and reveal to yourself a body that is not physical, then the top of the head of that body is totally different from this. We are not talking of this head. We are talking of the head of ourself, which is inside this body. So long as we merely practice going within this body, we are still physical. We gone nowhere. But when we go behind the eyes, we forget this body. This body dies. That's called dying while living. When you withdraw the attention and actually go there, you begin to become unconscious where your body is. You don't know where your hands are, where your feet are. You're only conscious of that space. The space widens. It becomes a big sky. You're in the center. You're flying in that sky. And that body itself has a head. You go there, and that also is only one head. Then you go within that. The ultimate truth, what we are talking of beyond the mind, is beyond the causal body, which you find within the head of the causal body, not here. It's a progressive realization of our own self. Yes.
A moment ago, you used a phrase, life after death. This gentleman died yesterday. Another friend of hers who was mourning her death said, or asked a question, and I think it was a rhetorical question, where is she now? And I would like to hear your answer to that question.
She's in an astral state, in a body that is not physical. A body that can still see, that can still hear, that can still touch, taste and smell, but is not physical.
Is she?
And still around.
Still around?
Yes. But don't try to search her. Don't try to search, because that doesn't help. The body is not physical. It's ethereal. Any other question? Yes.
Yes. You said initially that when we make decisions, then morality enters in. Did you say something of that nature?
Yes, I did.
His question about this man running around on his wife and the afterlife. My question, is it wrong to
Is it wrong to run around on the wife?
Yeah.
It is wrong. That's why he's afraid. That's why he's anxious. If he did not know it is wrong, he wouldn't be anxious and wouldn't be afraid. He created the morality while he ran around, and he's now afraid.
Yeah,
and because of that fear, he'll be punished.
But morality, thou shalt not commit adultery. Is that commandment just, is that true, or is that just...
It is true, that's why he's suffering.
Is it a fiction?
No, it's not fiction. While we are here, it's truth. It only becomes fiction if the whole mind and the whole setup here becomes fiction, which only happens if you go beyond the causal state. No. Not here. Here it's fact. It's not fiction now. Let me take you back to the experience and try to make it easier for you to understand the nature of the space behind the eyes where we have to be. First of all, you do not have to be focusing yourself on it. When you try to focus your attention on it, you are focusing in front of you, not on you. There is no way we can focus on something and be still on ourselves. Our power of focusing, as taught to us so far, is to focus on something other than yourself. If it is yourself, how are you focusing? It's not focusing. So don't try to focus on anything. Try to be there, not focus. Don't try to imagine you are looking at something. Don't try to make a little image of yourself. Close your eyes and make a little image of yourself in the darkness and say, I'm looking at it, therefore I'm focusing on it. That's not you. That's an image. You are the one looking at the image. The one looking at the image should be behind the eyes. Be there. Don't try to focus on something. Being there means imagine you are there. Imagine it's a space inside the head. You're actually sitting in the head. Yes.
So you imagine you're there, and say you imagine there's a stream and your feet are hot and you put your feet in the cold water, and then, you know, I mean, I can do that.
Yeah.
And is that what you're supposed to do?
Sure.
So you feel the rush of the cold water, you feel the heat of the sun.
Sure, but try to stay behind the eyes. Don't go down into the water.
Okay, and another thing is, and I'm new at trying to do this. I've been aware of this and I want to do it.
We are all very new. This is such an old thing. Even one lifetime is very new.
But what happened when I was experiencing that today is I found it was almost either I was excited about, oh yeah, it's working, or I was a little scared at, oh my goodness. You know, do you go beyond that?
Yeah. You have to hold on. Don't be scared.
Okay, you just keep riding the roller coaster?
Exactly.
But what do you, I mean...
Till you see the light.
What's the protection there?
The protection?
Yeah.
From what?
Well, aren't you, when you lower your consciousness or...
You're not lowering consciousness.
Okay.
That's what the protection is, not to lower your consciousness.
When you look at consciousness then, or trying to get to that self, can't other entities come in?
No.
Okay, so when you're searching for... Your truth, your the light and all that, other entity, bad entity, it's always good?
Because you are much stronger than those entities. If you start lowering yourself and become weaker than the entities, then the entities come in.
Well, some of us have some big...
I know. But since what I am suggesting is not to weaken yourself into a state of lowered consciousness where the entities can come in, but to stay strong. Stay strong behind the eyes and increase your strength, the entities will run away.
But how do you do that?
That's what I am going to suggest.
Okay.
Listen carefully. Listen very carefully how it is to be done. Yes.
There are two things I'd like to explore with you at your pleasure. One of them, you remember the famous Russian Pavlov psychologist? He personally taught me the principle of gradualness, which is very powerful. The idea that we can progress only so rapidly with our images and our processing of them. And the other one is a mathematical expression for the purpose of the universe. Have you ever come across this notion?
Yes.
Both of these are things that I think are very important. And
that's right.
And they can be done quantitatively.
That's very good. There's two points. Some of you may be interested in that. One is the principle of gradualness. There's nothing more effective than gradual building up of your experience. If you just want to have a sudden leap, you can be left high and dry not knowing what happened. But if you want to build solid knowledge, Make it gradual, stage by stage, step by step, layer by layer. Any experience that comes layer by layer, it's Pavlov's theory.
Yeah.
And it's correct, I agree with it. Layer by layer, when you build up, it's more solid, more sure, more entrenched in your memory, more recallable, more visually and through memory recall, a better experience for you. So don't be in a rush. Take your experience gradually, stage by stage. All the masters who have come have recommended that. They have recommended that we go in these experiences stage by stage and go up. And not that we suddenly want to have a leap and then we don't know what has happened. We don't know how to hold it. We don't know what to make of it. So gradual experience is built in a solid foundation and lasts much longer. Thank you. And the second about the mathematics, yes.
I'm going to read over and over again in Spiritual Gems, GM saying, slow and steady wins the race.
Correct. Thank you. Thank you for reconfirming the same principle. The mathematical side, that this can be also, that the whole thing is quantitative and mathematically designed, right up to the causal stage, it can be completely mathematically explained and mathematically explored. That's also true. So those who are interested in that line can explore that line if they wish. Right now, my interest in sharing this with you is to reverse our general tendency of taking our attention out and focusing on things, to reverse it to a practice of withdrawing consciousness within ourselves. That's the main purpose. If you can achieve that, the rest will follow gradually. If you can hold on to this experience of withdrawing attention and feeling comfortable and at home in the space behind the eyes, the rest will come. Gradually, don't worry about it. It will come. And it will build up gradually. Each time you'll have more experience, you'll find it is adding on to the previous experience. I am going to add a few variables to help you sit in that situation. I am going to add a few variables to bring other sensory perceptions into it. So that when you are there, you can see if the other senses work without the physical body. So what I am going to do is to take you to that space back, make you relax, sit on a chair, draw a little stool or a table next to you, imaginary. Put some imaginary flowers there, colorful flowers, and smell the flowers, and put some dessert next to you if you like sweets, or other snacks if you don't like sweets, and taste them during the exercise, so that you can know how powerful these sensory perceptions are, that they don't need either food or flowers to have the experience. Just to give you an example. And that will also give you more in-depth experience of the space. So let's begin. Close your eyes, be comfortable in the body. Make yourself comfortable to the extent that you are not distracted by the aches and pains of the body, and yet you are not so comfortable that you go to sleep. Find the right kind of a posture, a right asana. Close your eyes. Imagine you are sitting behind the eyes in that open space on a lovely floor. Imagine you are in your own chair or on your own mat or your own rug, which you have carefully chosen. Look at the chair, look at the rug, spread it out, sit on it. Go over it carefully, touch it and see that it's comfortable enough. Touch it with your hands and be sure it's comfortable, then sit on it. Relax, relax, don't be tense. No strain at all, don't put any strain. Just imagine it's there. Now pull a table next to you on the right side. Put a table there. On top of a table, place a flower, vase? Vase of flowers. Put a vase with flowers in it. Put it on one side. Now pick up those flowers in your hand and bring them in front. Look at those flowers. Look at the color. Look at the color and the shape of the flowers very carefully. Now put them back on the table. Pick up the flowers again. Bring them close. See if they have any smell, any scent, any fragrance. Check it out near your nose. Take a deep breath, see if they have any fragrance. Try again. put them back on the table. Now place a plate of food on the table. Some favorite dessert of yours or a favorite snack, the one that you really like. Imagine it is there on the table. Pick it up with your hand. Bring it in front and look at it. Do you recognize it? Is it the same dessert and the same snack that you are used to? Look at it. Eat a little bit of it. Eat and see how it tastes. Take another bite. Taste it. Be sure what the taste is. Have some more if you're not sure of the taste. Put it back on the table. Look around. Is everything okay? The chair, the mat, the table, is everything okay? Are things changing or are they still there? Watch what's happening. Stay in the center. Don't move away from the center of the head. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Look this side. Did you have a good feast? Anybody enjoyed? Please raise your hands. You enjoyed the experience. Who would like to share what happened? Yes.
Experience anything like this? This is my grandma's cooking. She cooks really good Gujarati food. And she had these rollies, and she wasn't there or anything, but I just picked one up and I had this.
Well,
I was really hungry, yeah. I could feel my mouth watering even afterwards. Even now, my mouth is watering.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, that was wild.
Wasn't it real?
It seemed real to me.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Was the taste good?
Oh, yeah.
What about the flowers? Did you see the flowers?
Mm-hmm.
What flowers did you see?
Roses.
Yeah.
What color?
Red.
Those are the now normal ones you saw. See, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're your favorites?
Oh, well, they smelled nice.
Smelled nice?
Mm-hmm.
Boy, you had a great experience. He was able to enjoy a real good meal. Anybody else want to share? Yes.
My dessert changed into something else. I had decided that I was going to do one thing and then I looked at it and it was something unexpected.
So you had to eat something that you didn't want to?
It wasn't that I didn't want it, but I didn't know that that's what it was going to be. And it was without my control, it turned out to be something else.
Didn't it surprise you?
Yeah.
You thought that you always imagine what you want to imagine. Isn't that true? It didn't work like that now.
Mm-hmm.
Some surprise?
Yeah.
I'll talk about it. Anybody else wants to share their experience? Yes.
I had to work hard at imagining, and then when you said, well, what do you see now? I didn't see anything.
You don't believe in imagining?
I don't do it very well, no.
Okay. Can you imagine that you are there?
Oh, I was there and I could do it all.
That's fine.
But I had to really work at it, and it just completely went away if I didn't pay any attention to it.
Don't worry about it. This was just an experience for some others, not for you.
Okay.
For you, the experience was to be there.
Yeah, I was there.
And that is the purpose for others also.
Yeah.
But they like little condiments around. Some embellishments. Don't worry. You didn't miss out on anything. Okay, anybody else? Yes, George.
If the environment that you envision is that significant as a message, I get the impression like I'm in an institutional environment, you know. Not an insane asylum, but I...
Not that kind of institution.
But that it is like a business environment. It's indirect ambient light. It's sort of in the gray scales. And there isn't a sense of any kind of, you know, like intimate environment. Is that a message of any... I mean, is that...
It is a message. You can interpret it. You don't want me to interpret it for you?
Well, I mean, I don't know if I'm...
You interpret it.
Well, I'm assuming, I would imagine that the image I create means that I'm supposed to have an impersonal attitude about everything, and that I'm trying to maintain some kind of a distance, like we're told. But I mean, it's like, all right, I'm getting down to business rather than I'm in my living room in my most favorite chair and, you know, I'm just going to really get in here and groove with myself. It seems like I have business to do with myself.
Right. Good interpretation. Who else? Anybody this side wants to share? Any goodies? Yes.
I'm an ice cream lover. And I had a big chocolate sundae. And then I sat back down, and then the Peter Buster parfait, and all this stuff, and it was kind of strange, because it was like, it was all on a table, and it was all just going by. And then there was a blueberry shake, and that was really good. You know, and I just had a week. But I mean, it was...
You had a big feast, then.
What?
You had a big feast.
Yeah, I mean, I had all this stuff, and it was just...
But that is not what you set out to imagine.
No.
So it came without your imagining. Okay. Yes.
Which one you spoke with the flowers and that I would have the experience, but when I tried to make it happen by suggestion, I had difficulty. In other words, with flowers, as soon as I saw them, I smelled them. But when I tried to tell myself to continue to smell them, I couldn't. And the same thing with the dessert. As soon as I saw it, you know, the saliva was going. In fact, I already took a couple pieces of it and ate some of it, but I was tasting it. But then after that, it was like, oh, I've had enough. And I didn't want any more. But I couldn't continue. Was that because the mind was getting involved rather than just letting it come to me?
Well, I'll talk about it. Yes, anybody else? Yes.
When I smelled flour, I couldn't physically smell it. I could smell it in my mind.
What kind of smell was it?
It came a pink-tipped white carnation.
Mm-hmm.
And when the dessert came, it was cheesecake, but I couldn't taste it. My body could react to the physical sensation of the sugar and everything, but I couldn't taste it. What does that mean?
That means you couldn't taste it. Are you missing it? Did you miss anything?
I guess it tells me that it's not really the food value for me that I need.
Correct. You got your own interpretation. You got the message, right? Okay. The message is not to eat too much. Yes.
Excuse me. In my flowers, I pictured there are beautiful yellow daffodils and pink tulips and purple little flowers. And when I went to smell them, because I have a bouquet like that at home, but they're artificial, I smelled them and I smelled dust. And but anyway, so should I at that moment said and tried to think about what a daffodil or a tulip?
No. You have to smell the flower that are there.
Well, they smell like dust because they're artificial.
They are artificial and they're full of dust.
Yep.
You can change them.
But
so you have to smell dust.
Should I direct myself to...
No. Don't direct yourself anywhere.
All right.
Yes.
Well, I just had to share it because she said my flowers were full of dust too.
Well, you're not alone. You're not alone. Anybody else had dusty flowers? Yes.
I never have... when I dream, I have black and white dreams all the time. They're never color. And when I try to visualize, it's always black and white. And this time when I was in the chair, I wasn't aware of anything until the flowers. And I wanted to have one of those Hawaiian flowers, that red, waxy ones. But when I brought it over in front of me, it was carnations, red carnations.
Beautiful.
I could see the red.
You saw the red?
I saw the red.
First time? First time ever?
Great.
Congratulations. Yes.
What happened to me was it had nothing to do with any of my senses. It was real nice, beautiful flowers, it was a beautiful dessert. It floated around and I was like, I wasn't here, I was there.
You enjoyed it?
I loved it.
Great feeling?
Yeah.
Good. This little exercise that we did, and from the sharing of experiences that you just heard, has proved a lot of points to us. One is, that our sensory perceptions do not work because of the physical sensory organs. They are independent. Not only are they independent, they are more autonomous than the sensory systems of the physical body. That they can create experiences for you the physical organs cannot create. It shows the power of the astral system in us, the power of the astral body. By imagination, we were not using the physical systems at all. By imagination, we went back into sensory systems, which means the imaginative system. And the imagination was able to pull out experiences, some related to memory and some not related to memory. Some things you saw which were not in your own memory. New things happened. You wanted to see one thing according to your own memory and your own plan, something else appeared. What does it mean? That the sensory system is working autonomously. That the astral body, which has created this experience, is more autonomous than you think. In fact, it is more real than you think. That astral body is actually responsible for all the seeing and the tasting and touching and smelling that we do. This physical body becomes an excuse for doing it. This physical body does not help us to do any of those five things. This physical body restricts how much we can see, how much we can smell, how much we can taste, how much we can do. This physical body is a cover upon it. It's a cage in which that astral body of imagination is trapped. And you'll find that you could do anything you like if you get released. If you had become unconscious of the physical body. This was a very short exercise we did. Very short exercise. You are fully aware of your body and you're just seeing things briefly. If you became unaware of this body with the other body, you could have done whatever you like. It had all the power, sensory power, that you needed. So we are trapped cage after cage. Of course, that is also a cage. The senses are also a cage. But the point is that that system is running on its own steam. It has its own life. That life is longer than the life of this body. That system through which this experience came is actually a longer experience than this body has had. And you can draw upon that experience whenever you like. It's trapped inside this body. And that's part of you. It's more part of you than this physical body. And yet we are constantly trying to take care of this body, never bothered about that. Of course, later on you will find that even that, in the second half I'll go into this question, that even that body is merely another body. It's not you. You are using that sensory body the same way like you use this one. There's no difference, except that is longer lasting. Looks ephemeral, because we are experiencing a gross physical world. A gross world where the sense of touch, the tactile sense, is a great proof of existence. Here we say this table exists because I can touch it. It's there, solid, heavy. We are so used to the proof of reality by gravity that if we eat too much food, why? We grow fat and heavy. We are sure we are here. That's not good enough. If we were to live with the body that we just experienced, we would be so light. We'd have no problem of weight. We could fly wherever we like. And that's us. That's part of ourselves. It's not outside. We're not examining somebody else. So this little experience shows how much potential there is. And I just wanted to enlarge the area that when you go into the center behind the eyes, you have a capability of doing a lot more than you can ever do here. Your potential increases, does not become less. And it looks imagination because of our assumption. We made an assumption that only this is real. And anything that is lighter than this must be unreal. Anything that is ethereal, imaginative, must be unreal. If it is unreal, where is it coming from? Here somebody wanted to have one thing and got another. Something else. He says in his physical self, he wanted one thing. When he went there, that thing didn't appear, another thing appeared. I asked him, so you got something that you didn't want? He said, no, I wanted that too. Now he doesn't know the conflict. The physical body in the physical trap decided to have one thing. When released from it, the astral body wanted the other thing, and that came. Did that happen with anybody else? That you thought of one thing, another came? There. So you see, now it shows that the ethereal body, the astral body, has its own life and a much more powerful life. much more autonomous life than this physical one. As we proceed further, you will find that the causal self or the mental self has even greater autonomy than this. It can create any experience it likes. That our mental self or mental body, causal body, can create any experience. Indeed, it is creating every experience, and that's why we are here. That the experience is being generated, this world is being generated around us, not because it is placed outside. God did not create this world outside and then say, now you go. He created the world inside and then he said, go and experience. The world has always been created in the consciousness, and then we are sent out to experience it. And the process of creation is from within outward. And we can have it, have a proof of it by going within and seeing how it is being created. Let's do this exercise once again. But this time don't eat any dessert. You don't have to worry about that. That was just an exercise. The important point is, withdraw your attention and listen. This time the emphasis is only on one sense, listening. What can you listen? While you are trying to listen, you may also see some things in front of you, colors, purple color, blue color, red color, waterfalls, lights twinkling, little stars. You may see many things, big blobs of unpatterned dark and light shades moving across like this, as if floating around. You know what you saw. So those things will come. When those images come in front of you and pass, don't follow those images. The moment you follow those images, you are away from the center. Stay back. Let the images float in front of you and go away. You stay back. The more you stay back and let the images float away, the more it will get lit up. There will be more light and more color to see. If you try to follow a light or color, it disappears. When you try to go back and relax, it comes back again. So don't try to move forward. Try to stay back and relax and watch from there. Keep your chair in the center. If you are not sure if you are in the center, to start with, you can put your hands on your forehead at the back of the head with eyes closed and have a feel, have a tactical feel of where the center would be. Put your hands on the ears. Maybe that's too far behind. I never thought it is in the center. So you have to push back a little more. So you can determine what is apparently the center of the head and then imagine you are there. If you imagine you are there, listen if you can see and hear anything. If nothing else, at least you will hear your thoughts. At least one thing is always there. Your thoughts, spoken thoughts, in language, in words. That never stops. So it is not that you may have a blank period, oh, I had nothing to listen to, so I just sat there. It has never happened like that. If there's nothing else to listen to, at least you can listen to your thoughts. But don't try to direct your thoughts. Don't try to say, I want to listen to that. No. Don't try to imagine something particular. No. Don't try to create something by suggestion. No. You're not here to suggest something and create an image. You are only imagining. You are there. What comes is natural. Don't create anything by suggestion. The only suggestion you have to use is that you are there. What comes, you take it. What you see is not important. Ignore it. Whatever comes in front, the images, let them come and go. You may see some faces. You may see some strange faces which you've never seen before. You may be curious to see. See them from a distance. Let them go. During this exercise, I have seen several times past life faces come up of people that you've seen in past lives. You've never seen them in this life at all. And you wonder, how can you, are you making up these faces? You're not making up anything. It's just at that level of consciousness, you can pull things from previous lives in front of you. So when they come, just ignore them. Let them come and go. You only see what can you listen to. Concentrate on listening at the center. If you are in the center, can you hear anything? The thoughts are there, any music is there, any other sound is there, any other strange kind of audible experience is there. Watch out for that. Clear? Close your eyes. Go to the center. Relax. If you didn't like your chair, change it. It's a good time to exchange. New furniture. Don't like your mat, change it. Sit on it in a relaxed position. Relax enough not to be detracted by any aches and pains.
and keep awake. Don't go to sleep. Keep awake and listen. What can you listen? Move back further in the center. Further back in the center. Push your chair back if necessary. Push it with your feet, chair back to the center of the head. Stay awake, stay in the center. If you hear anything, listen to it. If you hear your thoughts, listen to them. If any other sound, any music comes, listen to that. Give up the thoughts. Any kind of other sound is better than the thoughts. If no sound comes, then listen to the thoughts. If any other sound can be heard, listen to the sound. Any sound, however faint, see where it's coming from, but don't move from the center. Listen from the center. Listen quietly, intently. From the center, don't move. Don't go forward towards the images. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Look this side. Open your eyes. Look this side. I'm sorry I interrupted this exercise because I know some of you were really having good time. Is that true? Some of you are having good time? I'm sorry. I had to. Because I got a signal that we have to have a break. In the first half of this workshop, we were exploring the reasons for fear and doubt, the situation in which we are placed, in which the body, mind and senses have taken over our own identity. We have lost our identity by misidentification with body, senses and mind, and how we can recover our own identity by going within and finding the truth about our own self. That self-realization can give us direct knowledge of the nature of our own self and give us enough power, knowledge and wisdom to take away all fear. We just started at the end of the first session some exercises to see the approach towards going within to oneself and to see what are the kind of things that come in our way when we want to go within. You will notice that when we want to sit there behind the eyes, the most distracting thing are the thoughts. Is that true? Who felt like that? Please raise your hand. That's so common that the most distracting thing in sitting at the third eye center are our own thoughts. Our own thoughts lead us to places other than the center. Because we think about things and we think about people and we think about activities elsewhere. We think about what happened. We remember things that happened. This memory and this constantly moving through our thought process into different situations outside of ourselves does not let us stay there. Therefore, these mystics and masters who have come here to tell us the way to go within our own true self, they tell us that this is a normal obstacle, but you should have a way to overcome it. The way to overcome the distraction of the thought is to substitute the thought by words which are not thought. A very simple device, that the thoughts are taking us away, they won't stop, there's no way we can stop them, they come in voluntarily, they are there all the time, we can do nothing about them. What we can do is to put other words in place of those thoughts and let those words run in the same space so that eventually the thoughts will be washed off and these other words will come in place. These bland words which are not thought, bland words which do not take our attention out, they can replace the words of thought and thereby remove one major obstacle in our meditation. These bland words are called by a not so bland label, mantra, the repetition of holy words, the repetition of words that have reference to the truth, the repetition of words that refer to God, the repetition of words that refer to the Creator, the repetition of words that refer to the word, the sound, the repetition of words that refer to any inner experience, the repetition of words that have no association outside, all the association is inside. When we repeat these words, first of all, there's no distraction. If there is, it distracts us to something within. so we still move within. This device has been used for centuries. For centuries we have been told that the way to control the distraction of thoughts is to induce, in other words, to take their place. And that is why all these mystics and all these masters have used words to tell us, repeat these words in meditation. We repeat the words to perform a very ordinary mechanical exercise. But you know, we don't understand. Many of us follow like blind sheep. We follow like sheep, like blind people. We just do because somebody is telling us. I don't want any one of you ever to follow anything blindly. I want to make it very clear. In the instruction I got from my master, he made sure, repeating it again and again, don't accept anything blindly. Test it out, check it out, understand it, absorb it, go through it, experience it, then say, yes, I've got it. Yeah. Such an important part of the teaching I got, and I must share this caution with you all the time. Why do I have to share this caution? Because I see thousands of very enthusiastic seekers, thousands of true, thirsty people who want to find the real truth, just being misled, just by strange kind of rituals, strange kind of superstitions, they are being led. Blind are leading the blind, and they are running after them because they are thirsty. Don't do that. See things with eyes open. Don't say that the truth will come to you in a trance where you don't know what's going on. Truth should come to you when you are fully awake and you can see the truth and see there's nothing wrong about it. So don't accept anything blindly. My master said to me, do not accept even the word of the master unless you can verify and see with your own eyes. I believe in that. That is why we can make too much of a mantra. Oh, these are very powerful words, and this particular mantra has that property and that. How do you know? It's a blind faith. I know that every mantra, even one you can coin right now, you can invent one now, has the power to replace the words of thought and therefore is mechanically sound in meditation. This is scientific. Anyone can do it. If there is something more to it than in a mantra, understand that also. I can explain that too. But you don't have to believe everything. You have to test it out. You have to practice and then see what happens. I want to tell you the other side, lest you get away with the feeling that all mantras are just bland words being spoken. They are not. Mm-hmm. But bland words can perform that mechanical function. Mm-hmm. But because these words that the masters give us are specifically associated with certain inner experiences, they get some special power. What are words? Let us see, what are words? What is language after all? Language and words of language are nothing more than phonetic symbols, sound symbols, which have acquired a meaning, a connotation, by constant use, by association of ideas. We have been hearing this called a cup or a glass. It's a cup or a glass. Every time we hear, we see the same thing, we associate with it. So when, even when it is not there, we talk of a cup or a glass, that thing comes in front of us. It's purely by association of that sound that we have created a word with a meaning. That's the only way all languages have been developed. All languages are phonetic symbols which meaning connotation has been given by association of ideas. And every time we use a word, that concept comes up before us. But as we grow older and the words are repeated, their meaning grows in depth. For example, we say there's a chair. Now that chair, I can look at that chair and say it's a chair, but when I don't look at it and say chair, I don't mean this chair, I mean all the chairs. By one word, I can see all the chairs. By one word, I need not see any chair and I still know what the chairs are. So by seeing 100, 200, 500, 1,000 chairs and still using the same word chair, the idea of what a chair is comes up and becomes a meaning and does not require a chair to be present. It does not mean a specific chair. It does not mean what size it is. It does not mean what it is made of. Whether it's metal or it's wood or what, a chair means a chair. So the meaning becomes much deeper by greater association. When these masters give us words for mantra arising from their association of ideas, their experience of what that word signifies for them, they are referring to powers that are above the physical. They are describing astral and causal and spiritual states and using those words. When they use that word with us, their mind is seeing that state. So when they give that word, the word lends power because it means all that. It means all of that when they say that word. It doesn't mean for us because we haven't seen the state. But when we see the state, as we arise, we find it is not their word, it is our word. That we uttered those words ourselves at that higher state before we descended into this illusion. So they are not telling their language, they are telling our own language. They are speaking our language, they are speaking words we have forgotten. Therefore, those words when we speak, they have a strange resonance because we have forgotten that we have our own association of ideas with those sounds, but they are not of the physical level, so we have forgotten them. But they ring true and they have that power of association because they were our words. That's a great secret. I'm not supposed to be sharing all the secrets, but this is one secret I'm sharing. Nobody will tell you this, that the secret of the power of a mantra exists in the fact that the mantra is a word we have spoken in a higher state. And having lost that state, we are now coming back to the same word through the mouth of another person who is at the same state with us in the higher level. And that gives it power. It's for your information that mantra can have that power because of this reason. But right now, for our exercise, mantra is a word that doesn't mean anything to us. If it does mean anything, it means something within ourselves, so it does not distract. By repeating the mantra, by repeating these words, or a word, you can take one word and keep on repeating it. Or you can take five words and repeat them, or you can take a whole verse and repeat it. By repeating that again and again, we do not give enough room for thoughts to come in the stream of consciousness. And therefore, the stream of consciousness becomes clear, and the ability to withdraw attention behind the eyes at the third eye center increases. It's that simple. How many of you know any mantra or have any? Good. In the next exercise, please use it. In the next exercise, repeat it. How many of you have no mantra, no words to repeat? Good. Make your own mantra. Make one word or a short word, either take up a sound that you do not understand. Take a sound, take a word that you don't understand, use it. Or if you must use words that you understand, pick up a word that means something of an inner experience, such as experience of love. If you say something constantly about the experience of love, it is an inner experience. It's a spiritual experience. Let me clarify, love is always a spiritual experience. There is no such thing as higher love, divine love, lower love, this kind of love. There's only one love, and that's spiritual and divine at all times. But lust and attachment is not love, nor are they divine, nor spiritual. But we mix up these. If we start calling our attachments with people as love, we are making a mistake in use of the word. If we call our lust for opposite sex and call it love, it's our mistake. We're calling some animal activity as love. Love is love, always, between human beings. And when love is there, it's always love. It's always spiritual. Always comes from the soul. It's always the highest quality we have. You can have coin a phrase or a word connected with the experience of love, spiritual love, of identification with the soul. When you pick up that, you can use that and repeat it. Make your own mantra if you don't have one. In the next exercise, when you withdraw to the space behind the eyes and sit comfortably with your mind, repeat those words. Repeat the word or the words slowly, deliberately, listening to what you are repeating. Listen again. Slowly, deliberately, listening to what you are repeating. Don't repeat like a parrot. If you keep on repeating the word like a parrot, your mind is thinking of other things all the time anyway. Repeat it with that mind which is thinking. Repeat with the mind, not with the tongue. Yes.
Such as the word is divine, then am I just saying it and saying it faster, or am I interpretation of my impression of what divine is to me?
Yes.
What, yes to which one?
To your impression of what divine means to you.
Okay, should I picture something divine?
Yes. Picture something divine, use that word and hold it.
And okay, so does the picture keep moving and changing along with the word?
You don't know. See what happens. Why do you want to control it? You just
life.
No life. You shouldn't control.
I know.
You want to control something? Control the repetition of the word.
Okay.
Repeat the word in your control. The rest should come by itself.
Do you say it reverently then?
Very reverently, very deliberately, very attentively, very earnestly,
purposely.
Very enthusiastically, purposely,
okay.
So purposely that you can hear every syllable of
okay.
it.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Welcome. Okay, are you all ready? Okay, close your eyes. Go back into the third eye center, your own center, your space. And once you have settled down, don't start off your mantra at once. Don't start at once. First, center yourself in. If you don't center yourself at the third eye center and start repeating, you will be centering on these chairs on which you are sitting. Move your consciousness from the chairs. Believe you are behind the eyes in your head. First become meditators in the head, not on the chairs. The body is being placed on the chairs. You are inside the body. You are inside the head. Imagine you are in the head. Once you have imagined you are there, then start repetition of the word. Repeat slowly, deliberately, listening to every syllable of the word. Don't lose the center. Stay in the center. Do it at the center. Nowhere else. Don't move away. Stay awake. Stay in the center. Make your mind repeat the words at the center. And listen to it. Listen carefully to the words you are repeating. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes and look this side. Open your eyes. You're happy?
Yeah.
Right?
Well, that's it.
Yes.
Up and down.
Good.
But, yeah.
Keep it up.
Yep.
Any questions on what we just did? Does it make it easier by repeating words? Does it help in stopping some distraction of the mind? Good. Yes.
I have another question.
Yes.
How long does a person meditate for? And I noticed each time that we were coming, you know, it was to end, you said, you know, I'll count one, to five. How do we, when you're not here, how do we...
Don't stop when I'm not here.
Okay. I won't, but how do you...
Keep going.
Stop.
You don't
point?
Stop.
Well, you could do that all day.
You should do all life.
But there's, other things you have to do just to live.
I will tell you a way by which you can keep on doing it even when you are doing other things in life.
All right.
Isn't that good enough?
I'll listen.
Okay. Any question? Any other question on what we are doing? Yes.
How much attention should be given to maintaining the place? It's easy enough for me to think the mantra. It seems to me that when I meditate at home, about for the first half hour, every once in a while I'll begin to get this thought, am I in the third eye center? And then after that, it seems like I'm there all the time. But in that first period of maybe half an hour or so, I keep having this thought, am I in the right place?
So long as we have body consciousness, that means we are aware of our body. Till then, we have to keep on focusing on where the third eye center is. Once we are starting enjoying being in the center, we should forget about it. You don't have to think again. Because once you start going into a higher region, a third eye center, and you go into experiences beyond, the body doesn't exist. You don't have to then bring it back to find out where the third eye center is. Then go with the flow.
Mm-hmm.
But if the body consciousness comes back, yeah, and you feel you are in the body, then you have to figure out again if I am in the third eye center and pick up from there again.
So that thought that comes is sort of automatic.
Yes, it comes automatically. Yes, it comes automatically with the body consciousness. So don't give it any undue importance. Don't say that you have to bring it back. You don't have to specifically bring it back. Just enjoy and fly in the sky. Fly in that sky. You understand? Yes.
I'm imagining that I'm in a head-shaped room with eyes in front and a big wooden floor and ears kind of on the side so that I'm roughly in the center. And it's not like there is any body consciousness, but is that the right thing to do?
Yes. You are there. Aren't you there?
Yeah.
That's all we need.
Okay.
You don't need anybody else. That's it.
Okay.
You be there and repeat words there.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. Yes. And listen to them. Yes.
Just now when I'm sitting here and doing this exercise, I started out by saying this Om Mani Padme Hum. And I usually never use mantras at all. But after a very short time, I mean almost, let's say within a few seconds, then I'm hearing my shot. Which in my case is usually always a very high pitched, like a three pitch type of sound. They're alternating, integrating different rhythms, intricate patterns. That's what that sound is. But today, just now for the first time, I thought I heard a faint sound of church bells ringing coming from my right side, like a church must be getting out someplace near here. And I thought, gee, I could open my eyes and see if anybody else is hearing this church bells ringing. But I've never heard bells ringing before until just now.
Anybody else heard any church bells ringing today? Well, she heard them too.
Oh, maybe there's a church around here.
There's a church, maybe.
There's someone up the street.
Someone up the street.
I think it's an interior.
It's a good sign. When you hear the bells, it's a progress. Because the first basic sound that pulls us up, the others are all practice sounds. The first sound that can really pull us is the bell sound. It looks like church bells from a distance. It looks like at some distance some church bells are ringing. That's how the sound first appears. Then seems to gradually that either we are moving towards it or it's moving to us. Or it's fading and coming in and again. But that's a good progress. That sound has the power to pull. Hold on. When that sound comes, you can leave everything else.
I mean, maybe you're saying that a couple of years ago. If you're doing it as some kind of a mantra and if they're hearing this sound, it just comes. You can let go of the mantra.
Yes.
Focus on that.
This sound is the real mantra.
Okay. Now, when this happened to me a couple of years ago, or maybe more than that, actually, I had already been hearing that sound for a couple of years. And as far as I know for sure, it just happened spontaneously. You know?
Yes, yes.
But that sound then was the same, and I don't meditate very much, but that sound has not changed. It's still the same as I just described. It's really high pitched.
Right.
So I think, how can you make anything out of that, how that relates to your singing?
That sound just precedes the sound of the bell. Yes. So you are just close to it. But if you stay at that level, you will keep on hearing the same sound. But if you center yourself, the bell sound will come. The more you stay in the center, the stronger the bell sound will become. Yes.
I might sound like a castle that. What is the point of being able to do this for a half hour, hour, whatever time? I mean, if you're not thinking about anything, I mean, I don't understand where the benefit comes.
The benefit is you get to know yourself. And when you get to know yourself, you get a power and ability to solve all your problems. Right now, when we don't know who we are identifying with the body, we don't know ourselves, we can't handle things around us. By doing this, you get to know who you are.
And does that come fairly quickly?
Depends. Some people has come very quickly. Some they have taken a long time. Depends on how much baggage we are carrying. As I said in the morning, depends how much baggage, other attachments we are carrying, other desires we are carrying. If we're carrying too much of that stuff, it takes time.
Yeah.
If we don't carry too much, we are single-minded, it comes fast. Yeah, you hear them. Ultimately, you will see in the songs, the music of the musical instruments comes up in the background, and you should pick up that then. Okay? So far, we have treated this whole meditational process as if it is just a mechanical science. That here's a lab, and we're sitting like scientists, and we are performing this. It's not like that. We are concerned with the soul, the spirit, the essence of God, the essence of the Creator. And that essence is love, not a machine. It's not a mechanical thing. I try to simplify it. I try to introduce this subject to you in a simple way so that you can have a methodology, a practice, a system by which you can start in finding out what it is all about. That the truth is, if you want to have real experience of going within, you have to connect yourself with the essence of your own spirit, which is love. Therefore, if there is no love and devotion in us, sitting behind the eyes at the third eye center, we don't make much progress. We can sit there a long time. The more we have what she called reverence, what she called devotion, what this person talks of as love, the more we have that attitude of love and devotion, the greater the progress. In fact, my own master, the great master, told me that this meditational exercise is not what takes us to higher regions. It's the love and devotion that takes us there. He said the meditational exercises are like a thermometer. You know the thermometer to measure the temperature when you have fever? The thermometer does not give you fever. It measures the fever. The meditation does not take you inside. It only measures how far you have gone. Meditation is a measuring device. It is not an instrument for going to higher stages. The instrument for going to higher stages is love and devotion. Therefore, don't treat it in a mechanical way. If you want to have your meditation successfully done, when you are sitting there and you are repeating the words or listening to the sound, you are repeating the words if there is no sound. If the sound comes, leave the words and listen to the sound. If the sound becomes faint, pick up the words again. If the sound comes again, leave the words, pick up the sound. The sound will take you up. That sound is resounding in us all the time. Our attention is not there. When the attention is gathered in the third eye center, the sound will become so loud, so beautiful, it will pull us up. That sound is the secret. But the more we sit with love and devotion, the more easily we get the sound. So meditation should be always done with the spirit of love and devotion. Now love and devotion, that's where the rub is. How can we have love and devotion? Who do we love? What does it mean? That's where in the Eastern system, the master stepped in. As a human being, we could love him. We could love his face. We could see his love and compassion. Look at him. We have always wanted a face, particularly a fatherly face or a loving face or somebody that we could call something of a beloved, something that we can truly love. Without that, we can't really have love and devotion. We can only have a mental jugglery. We can love pictures, we can love statues, but we cannot have true love and devotion in our meditation if there's no one to love. That is why it becomes more important than ever to have a human being. It need not be a special human being, it can be an ordinary human being, but a human being where the love and compassion flows from that human being. If you can find such a being, then you have a focus point to consider that love of that human being. And with that love, combine it with the meditation at the third eye center and see how your attention is focused onto the third eye center. I'm sure you all have had experience of love at some time or the other. You can all visualize the image, the face of the beloved. Now when we do the exercise, do the mantra with love and devotion with the beloved in mind. And you can speak other things too, all concerning the love and devotion for your beloved. If you speak with that tone of love and devotion, you're likely to get much more from meditation. Let's try again, this time with love and devotion. Go back to the third eye center. Don't move your situation, your attention away from third eye center. That's where all the goodies are. That's where the secret is. You cannot be outside and do these things. You have to be inside, at the third eye center, behind the eyes. Be there. Then do your meditation, then do your repetition, then do your mantra, then do your simran. And while there, do it with love and devotion, with humility, with love, devotion, feeling of reverence. Whatever makes you feel that there is a devotion in your heart, do that with visualization, if necessary, without visualization, if possible. Go ahead, close your eyes and have a good session at the third eye center. With love and devotion. Don't you see the beauty of the beloved? Don't you see the compassion and that love flowing? Have you experienced anything like that? Can you remember it? Can you see it? Look into the countenance of the beloved. Look into the face. The moist eyes full of love and so much feeling. So much transference of love taking place just by looking. Remember that. See that now. Stay in the center. smile, cry, laugh, tears, do anything, but don't give up this love and devotion when you're doing your meditation. Relax, keep awake, relax. No strain. Stay back. Third eye center, not in the eyes. In the center, behind. Move back a little. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes, look this way.
Do you approve of the four-dimensional mantra?
Yes, yes.
It's very fine.
Yes.
If tears or laughter come during this process, is that still, is that indicating that the body is still too much involved?
No.
Tears come as not?
No, it's good. Because during this process, we have to get over a lot of emotions, which is part of our baggage, and tears and laughter help us to get over it. It's good.
I was doing the mantra, and all of a sudden I heard this bell, bong, bong, and I got caught up in the bell and just like I lost everything. And it was, I didn't know where I was. There were colors and the bell. And,
all the bells.
Yeah.
Everything.
Back to the mantra, but the bell
No, forget the mantra. The bells come, forget the mantra. Bells can take you everywhere. Hold on.
How much of an effect can digestion or a heavy meal have on meditation? Is that
makes it more difficult. We should have no workshops after lunch, because eating too much interferes with good meditation. Light meal is helpful. The lighter we eat, the better for meditation. So it does make a difference. In the beginning, when you're trying to center, you don't know what is being centered, so you're trying to locate your position and you can get dizziness. But when you're centered, it'll disappear.
Tinnitus effectively blocked, trying to hear the bells. Occasionally I have tinnitus, and it gets pretty loud sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like I can't get through that. But if I lock on right, will the bell sound come through the tinnitus?
There is a way of doing it, and that is to move away from that sound. When it comes, move away from that sound to the other side. And if in the middle of it another sound comes, it'll go through it. Yes, any other question? Yes.
Pop songs floating through my head. Earlier, before lunch, this Please Forgive Me by Brian Adams was just floating through my head. And now, when you say a key word like love, well then, this song by Amy Grant, I think, That's What Love Is For, that was floating through my head.
You should listen to it.
Is that okay?
Okay, I gave that answer to that young girl there. Yes, if the song comes, listen to it. The important is not what is being sung, but you're listening. Your listening will center you.
Pardon?
Your listening. The more intently you listen, that will center you in the third eye center. Not what song it is. So if you like a song and it comes, listen to it. But listen at the third eye center. We can listen to the same song sitting out in the body, and the same song can be listened by sitting there. You should listen to the song sitting there. It'll help the same way. The real thing is listening. Yes.
So is the idea to favor what you listen to, what sounds more pleasing to you? Sometimes the mantra is more pleasing to me than listening to one of the practice sounds.
Mantra is better in that case. Yes.
Ishwar, Dr. Julian Johnson, the American doctor that went over to India and studied with your master, correct?
Yes.
In his book, can't think of the name of it. Anyway.
Path of the Masters?
The Path of the Masters, right.
Mm-hmm.
He talks about the Shabd, and he calls it the sound of the living stream. I think you said one time several years ago that it was almost like when God created the universe, it was like the sound of the living stream is the word. And if that sound ever stopped, everything would just kind of fall apart. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So the sound of the living stream can manifest like bells or a train coming by or all these various sounds.
That's right.
But what we're doing is catching part of that living stream.
That's right.
Okay.
Exactly.
And if we kept working at it and got better and better at it,
yeah. What
would the sound be then, or wouldn't there not be?
Sound would change to different forms, and eventually, as the sound changes, your scenario changes,
experience changes and your level of consciousness changes. And the same sound alone, by its changes to different levels, can take you right up to the top. It's a connected sound. It's unbroken. From the true home, our true home, from the Creator up to this point, the sound is unbroken completely. All other experiences are broken. We go to sleep, we break from this experience to go into a dream. We wake up, we break the dream experience to come here. From here, we go to the astral state, we break this experience. Every other level of consciousness is a broken experience, one from the other. The sound is the only connected experience, never breaks. It's a royal road. Julian Johnson elsewhere might have mentioned, my master, the great master, saying, this sound, if you go along the sound, you are on the royal road. Nothing can be easier than this. And yet, because of our distractions, we don't hear the sound. The sound is going on so loudly all the time. We don't hear it because of our distractions. If we gather our attention towards ourselves, we'll hear it all the time. It's 24 hours. It's not only during meditation. The sound is there all the time. Once you practice it, you will hear it all the time. And that's the sound. The more you hear it, the more it will take you to higher levels of consciousness. Yes?
Does this always come gradually, this growth, or could it be a breakthrough and you would hear it in its full force?
It's better to come gradually, as he said, Pavlov formula, that if it comes gradually, it is more stabilized. If it breaks forth at once and it disappears, you are a very disappointed, sad man then, till it comes again. But gradually picking it up and building it up slowly, it's at a distance, it comes near, that's a better solid foundation. Yes?
What about when sounds, sometimes when I'm meditating, sounds come out of me. And it's not like I'm saying English words, but they sound like words. I don't pay any attention to them. I just let my body speak them. But a lot of times with them will come a real sense of love and devotion and peace, and just a real fine feeling. And sometimes it comes out as a song. It has a real harmonious, like, resonance in my head and through my whole body. It makes my whole body just feel like almost like the air and the body are becoming one. It's just.
Have you practiced yoga?
I've done some yoga stretching and breathing.
You have. This is because of that. Now let me explain. In some types of yogic practices where we do with the breathing, pranayama, you might have heard of pranayama, the breathing exercises, there are several physical bodily sounds that come up during that experience. They are not the same sound in the head, the same resonance, but they do come up during that practice. Sometimes when we shift from that and try to center on the third eye center, some body sounds appear again and they come up. But on top of these body sounds comes the resonance inside the head. That resonance is the one to be caught. The rest should be let off. See?
Years ago when I was practicing yoga and standing on my head, the sound of the tuning fork, or like a tuning fork, would occur. And over the years, I've been doing something and there's that sound of the tuning fork again. Today, when you said, hear a sound within, the air conditioner was the most prominent. Within, I was hearing an almost inaudible sound, and I couldn't distinguish the tone, but it was there. It was very soft, and I can't say distant because it was permeating close by, but it was very soft. I don't know what my question is, but it's either one of them valuable or...
That's more valuable than the air conditioning. And the soft one, the soft, almost inaudible one, is more valuable than the tuning fork. This sound of our own consciousness, the sound of the living life stream that connects us to our ultimate home, that's a very subtle sound. It's very subtle. And when it comes, it is so soft. It's a vibration, but it's not a physical jerking vibration. It's a very soft, melodious sound. It's the most subtle and soft sound that you can ever hear. So it's a very beautiful sound. And the subtlety of the sound, it has a pull, a strange kind of intoxicating pull that sound has, which lifts you from one consciousness to another. So that subtle sound should be preferred to the other sound. Yes?
If a master is around and awake and he says, or she says, I want to go and get connected again, can they simply in their mind, after centering themselves, can they make that thought, that sound appear inside of their inner self, and then that will automatically connect them to the higher level?
Absolutely.
Is that how a master would often do that?
A master should normally never break that connection. They don't break the connection. They remain connected even when they are talking to us here. Even while they are working here, they are talking to us. They are doing a lot of work elsewhere at the same time. In fact, the masters don't need to give more than 10% of their attention for our work. 90% of their attention is elsewhere even at that time. Yes. It's partially a gift and partially practice. The more you practice, the more gifts you get. There's a little catch in that. Yes.
Can physical processes be used, such as drumming, in order to get to the, or at least attempt to get to the ultimate level of meditation? Might be a device to use as a technique?
People have used that technique. In several cultures, they have used outsiders, playing of drums, playing of different instruments, creating a music, singing of hymns, chanting. This has been used extensively in order to generate that kind of an experience. But if that experience is being generated as an aid to listening within, it does help. What has happened is, like most other spiritual teachings, that when people use that as an aid to going within, they forgot the within and they stuck with the aid and they thought the aid was everything. So you see people chanting, playing drums and having ritualistic music, and that's it. They're not using it as an aid for anything. So the danger of doing these things is that the external aids which were used to go within have now become an end in themselves. So all religions which started off with pure spirituality have ended up in ritualistic activities. And we are all doing ritualistic, superstitious things without understanding why we are doing it. But we think they are good, that this is what God wants us, so we are doing it. We get nothing, we are still angry, we are still lustful, we are still greedy, we are still attached to things, our life has not changed, we keep on going every Sunday, we keep on doing the same thing in a ritualistic way, never going in within. Those were the very aids to help us, but we did not use them as aids. We began to think, this is it. Same thing is true with the reading of books. The scriptures were written, so those are like manuals. It's a manual, what to do. But we thought reading the manual is doing it, and we keep on reading. So we've gone wrong, only this, that instead of doing the real thing, which was within, which is very difficult. I want to make a confession. All this day, since morning, I've tried to make it sound so easy. I want to make a confession, it's not that easy. Why do I have to say this? Because situated as we are in this modern civilization, with all the distractions and all the kind of lifestyles we lead, they all come in our way when we try to sit within. The mind puts up a fight when we want to go within. That is why it does not remain easy. If the mind did not put up a fight, it is very, very, very easy. I can claim that. But since that is not a practical reality, I have to confess that it does take time. You can get part of it as a gift that helps, part of it as on your own effort. You make a combination. If you can find a truly enlightened master, by truly enlightened master I mean one who has not only reached these higher levels, but constantly operates from there. Just like I answered his previous question, that a master can, whenever he likes, he can go in. But a perfect living master of that level is normally always there when he's working here. Only part of his attention he's using for his worldly activity. And he's enjoying himself here, but he's enjoying much more within. His countenance is different. His appearance is different because he's not fully here. Sometimes we wonder why these masters act in a certain crazy way. They are crazy because they are not here. Most of the time they are somewhere else and they are just here for our sake. They are not here for their sake. They don't need anything here. They come here because it is their mission. They come here for us. We want them. They don't want us. We want them. And they give us in such a beautiful way. They cloak their teaching in such ordinary language. They generate in us, while they're talking about teaching, after a while we find that we forget the teaching and we are in love. What happens? They pull us with their love. They don't pull us with their teaching. The teaching is a starting point because of our intellect. Our minds want teachings. Our mind wants, how can I do it in this particular way, logically, correctly?
They say, here you do it this way. Do meditation. Repeat this. Follow this. And after a while we find, boy, that master is something else. We get attached. We get in love. And then the master pulls us. And we say, Master, I want your grace so I can get this. And he gives the gift. And we wonder what happened to the teachings. But if he hadn't started with the teaching, we wouldn't be there at all in the first place. So this is a strange combination in which we, having been accustomed to a world of doubt and fear, suddenly meet a person who's free from doubt and free from fear. It's an unusual experience. It's very rare to meet a person in this world who has no doubt and who has no fear at all in him. I have not seen any person except a perfect living master who is totally fearless and totally free of any doubt of any kind. To meet such a person is a strange experience. When you meet such a person, he has to respond according to our needs. We are still full of fears, we are still full of doubts, we want our doubts to be resolved, so he comes down to our level and starts teaching us from our level because we want him to teach like that. Very often he says the very things we want him to say. And we say, he knows. Why? Because he's saying what we want to hear. He takes the next step when we are in love with him, when we can't help listening to him, he says something else and moves us along on the path. So the master who is truly enlightened and is a perfect master, he works with us according to our needs at that stage, what we need from him. The great master, they play kind of games, the kind of games we like. When he found Julian Johnson, the author of The Path of the Masters, the American doctor who was a missionary, he had converted many people to Christianity. That was part of his mission. He worked in Calcutta, Julian Johnson, and he heard about the great master and decided to go and visit him. He read about him, heard about him. He took a train from Calcutta to Jalandhar in Punjab. The train in those days did not stop at the Dera where the great master used to live. It stopped either 25 miles short in a city called Jalandhar or 25 miles further down in Amritsar. So one had to get off in one of these two stations and drive. He wrote to the great master and the master said, yes, don't worry, you get off on the first stop 25 miles away from the Dera. I'll send one of my friends to pick you up from there. So one of the friends of the great master, his chief disciple, one of the very good disciples, was one Bhagat Singh, an attorney who used to practice in Jalandhar, who had a house in Jalandhar not too far from the railroad station. So the great master said, can you go and pick up Dr. Julian Johnson? He's coming from Calcutta. He's an American and he's taken a long time to come here. And I've been waiting for him. Will you go and pick him up and bring him to the Dera? He said, certainly, sir, I'll bring him up. So the attorney prepares to bring Dr. Johnson, and then great master says, but I have another idea. Why not I play a little game with him? He said, Master, you play games also? He said, sometimes when a guy wants to play a game, I play with him. He likes it. Probably he will like it. So he was responding to Julian Johnson's desire. He said, look, I will go also with you to Jalandhar, and I will hide in your house. So when Julian Johnson gets down from the train and says, take me to the master, you say, no, what's the hurry? Let's go and have a cup of tea in my house. He will say, no, I don't want to stop in the house. I want to go and see the master. You say, no, Julian Johnson, what's the hurry? Let's have some tea. It's a long journey. You are so tired. And bring him somehow to your house. There I will meet him and give him a surprise. And that's precisely what happened. Julian Johnson landed at the railroad station. Bhagat Singh, attorney, received him. And he said, I'm very happy you have come to this place to see great master. He said, yes, yes, I am keen. I am in a hurry to see great master. He said, what's the hurry? Come and step into my house. It's just near the railroad station. We'll have a little cup of tea and then we'll go to the Dera. He said, no, I have no time. I want to go to the master. I've not come here for tea. I've come here for the master. He said, no, it was a long journey. Doesn't matter. We'll only take half an hour on the way. He says, no, I have no time to lose. Take me to the master. He says, no, come on, let's have some tea. So reluctantly, Julian Johnson agreed to have tea at this attorney's house. So he goes to the house and the attorney says, I have a little surprise for you. So he opened the door and great master sitting right in front. And Julian Johnson was amazed, surprised. It had a big impact on him. Now what was the impact? I have talked to Julian Johnson several times about these incidents in his life, including this one, personally. the impact on him was that he has come to meet me. He loves me. That could never go away. What really impacted him was the love of the great master, not what he was going to teach afterwards. Teachings came afterwards. But he blew him off by his love in the first instance. He sat there. They took 2 hours before they left for the Dera. He sat there, spent time with him, just looking at his face. Just looked at the eyes, looked at the beautiful beard he had, looked at his smile occasionally. Couldn't say anything. Didn't know what to say. Just sat 2 hours. And he went to the Dera and he wrote out a letter. He typed out a letter to his folks back home in the United States. He said, I have come here to see the great master. Great master came to see me, which is a great thing for me. And I have spent 2 hours with him without talking to him. I have not asked him any questions. I have sat at his feet for 2 hours. If I get nothing more after this, I am still satisfied. I got all I wanted from my journey. When this letter reached his folks home, he said, this man's gone crazy. He's lost his sense. He's lost his head. How can he see a man, not even talk and discuss things with him, and he's satisfied? He's totally insane. But he got love. There's nothing like love. After that, of course, he spent all his time there and he had great experiences. He went in, he had meetings with Jesus Christ in the past, of the past. He wanted to explore all these things because he was himself trained in that tradition. He was a very devout Christian himself. And he wanted to explore all these ideas. Are these historical figures? Did actually things happen in the past? He wanted to see everything. He went back and saw 4 of his own lifetimes. He shared those experiences with me when I was very young. I was a child. It was great to see this man become such a great student and great disciple of the great master, as Julian Johnson. So these masters sometimes play strange kind of games with us, but they do it according to our needs, what we need. They come to our level, because if they don't come to our level, we cannot love them. Please remember this. We can worship them, but we cannot love them. If somebody is so far away from our level, sitting up in a pedestal, sitting up in the sky, in the heavens, we can worship, but cannot love. Love is when they come to our level, become human like us. And face to face, we can express love. So love is a great thing. It's the greatest. And comes to us in our human relationships. And what better thing to love in this whole creation except an enlightened being who is a master? And then you can get everything from that master. The master can give us everything in an instant if he wants to. It is for our good he gives us stage by stage, gradually, so that we don't just get and lose. We get it and keep and become like him. As I mentioned the other day, there is a stone called the Philosopher's Stone. The old alchemists who wanted to make iron into gold, they thought they could find a stone. If you rub that on iron, it will become gold. For centuries, this experience has been going on, people trying to convert base metal into precious metal. And this example has been used by the philosophers. So the particular stone that makes iron into gold has been called the Philosopher's Stone. You might have heard of it. The Philosopher's Stone makes iron into gold. And these perfect living masters have often been referred to as the Philosopher's Stone because they change us entirely. But the perfect living masters come and explain that a perfect living master is not like a Philosopher's Stone, because a Philosopher's Stone only changes iron into gold. But the perfect living master changes iron into the Philosopher's Stone. The masters don't come and make better beings of us. They make us like themselves. If they are complete and total in their realization, they come and make us just like themselves, complete and total in our realization. They don't want to give you a part of themselves. They give you the whole of themselves. They make you entirely like themselves. What greater compassion and love can you find? You don't find this anywhere else except in these perfect living masters. They are very rare. They are so rare in this world, you can always count on your fingertips at any time in the world. These people who have reached the level beyond mind, beyond Trikuti, beyond this third stage of the creation, beginning, middle and end, beyond that into timelessness. These people who come and have their consciousness pinned into that stage all the time when they are talking to us, they are very rare. There are not too many. Learned people, there are by the thousands. But these experienced, realized people are very rare. And the difficulty is because they operate like ordinary people, we can't find them. They wear a mask, the mask of ordinariness. Their mask is they look too ordinary. They're so ordinary, they're like us. So we can't see them.
We can't find them. Then how do we know they are there? Because they find us when we are ready. When we are ready in our own heart, in our own seeking, they appear to us through circumstances and coincidences. They appear to us through our destiny. And then once we find out, we have to ultimately go within to find their true reality. So when we find a master, we get initiated from a master. Initiation by a master means the connection he makes between us and the sound within. He connects it and he then represents the sound. The true form of a master is not the human being that we see. The true form of the master is that sound. Let me explain it to you here. That the sound that connects that word, that life stream, that stream that connects us to our Creator, that is the true form of a master. That sound itself reflects in a human form outside and becomes the master. And when we follow the instructions of the master and go within by meditation, we find that the true form of the master always was that. In fact, we see the radiant, illuminated, brilliant, lighted up form of the same master with the same face coming through the sound inside. And then we are convinced that we found a master. We can never know a master unless we reach that point. It's very difficult to know a master. We can't find out. There are no external criteria. There are a few guidelines, like a perfect living master. He'll do things in an ordinary way because he doesn't need to do anything extraordinary. With love, he can do anything. So why should he do anything extraordinary? Why should he perform magical tricks and do yogic exercises? Why should he stand on his head when he can stand on his feet and tell us the same thing? Why should he say, I want to fly in the air when he can purchase a ticket on American Airlines and fly? So he will do the things ordinary, but through the power of love, through the power of attracting us to our own inner self, he can take us to that point where we see his real form and we find he was a true master. Of course, these masters don't come to take anything from us. In history, you'll find that the perfect living masters did not come to beg for the living from us. They did not say, you give me a check and I'll pray for you. None of them said this. They are givers, not takers. They have got so much wealth in themselves. How can they come to take from us? They come to give us. We are the beggars. They don't come to beg from us. That is why you will never find these perfect living masters going about saying, you give us the money for our living. They will do any other work like us. They will take a job. They'll go and plow the land. They'll go and work in a factory. They'll go and mend shoes. They'll go and weave cloth. They'll go and drive a taxi cab. They'll do any ordinary thing and still do the work of the Lord, giving away love freely and giving themselves freely. That's a big difference. These are some guidelines how we can cross-check if a particular person could be qualified as a master. But the real thing is not these outward signs. The real thing is the inside. That when we go within, we find the true form of the master. We are lucky if we can be found by a master. And we are doubly lucky if the master accepts us as one of his sheep. Because each master who comes, who has ever come and walked upon this earth, has gathered his own souls and taken them back home. The master's mission upon this earth always has been to gather the marked sheep that he has been commissioned to take back. He takes them back home. And he will go anywhere in this planet. He will travel everywhere till he can find his last sheep and carry it, take it back home. So the masters come to pick up their marked sheep. And if we can be initiated by a master and we are part of his marked sheep, we're very lucky, extremely lucky. We spend too much time here messing around in this physical universe. It's time to go back and see what else is there. It's a beautiful place up there. We want to go back. So if we find a perfect living master, nothing like it. When we follow, live in the will of the Lord and live in the will of the master, that takes us away from the law of karma and takes us away from doubt and fear. You will experience, if you ever experience the presence of a perfect living master, you will see surprisingly how many doubts start disappearing. A clarity starts coming. Of course, our mind is strong. Sometimes things become so clear and we walk away. Next day, the clarity has disappeared again. So what has happened? Things seem to be so straight and clear. And now the mind is overwhelming us all over again. And we go back again. And in the presence of the master, again, so many doubts and cobwebs seem to disappear. And we seem to be so clear about things. Because it is his presence that takes the doubts away. Not what he's saying so much as his presence. The presence is what takes so many cobwebs away. And once those cobwebs are gone away and we can make progress, then we establish a companionship with the Master, of which there is no parallel. There is no greater friendship that one can have in this creation like the friendship with the perfect living Master. Because this is the only friendship I know which is totally unconditional. The Master does not impose conditions. If you do this for me, then I will do this for you. Everybody else does this. I have seen this world over and over again. People saying, we are in true love, and they still want to know, what have you done for me lately? They still want to ask whether you fulfilled your part. How can I do something for you? What did you do for me? I didn't expect this from you. I gave everything to you. And what did you give? Well, man, you never gave anything if you're expecting something in return. What did you give? It's only the Master. The perfect living Master, you become his friend. He gives you everything unconditionally. He loves you if you love him. He loves you if you don't love him. He loves you if you hate him. He loves you if you kill him. What else can I say? Where else will you find this? There's no parallel to that. That is why the true friendship in this world, anywhere in creation, is the friendship of a perfect living Master. And since the perfect living Master is not a body, not a physical body, the relationship is permanent. But one must do the homework, go within, establish contact with the word inside, establish contact with that resonance, establish contact with the true form of your Master, in which the same face can be seen if you are initiated. The same face will be seen, which you have seen here, you will see it inside. And that face, once you establish it and your attention is there, never goes away. You have a permanent companion forever. You are never lonely after that. You are never unhappy after that. And you are never afraid after that. That's the minimum one should do. To reach that state, then you are fearless forever. Let's get back into that practice. So you don't get carried away by the words and forget that the practice is the real thing. Now, those of you who have a Master, anybody has a Master? Living, perfect, living Master, you are satisfied? If you have, visualize. If you don't, visualize anybody you love so much that you can have full faith. Visualize the picture. Now, instead of merely having love and devotion in an academic sense, have a visualized picture. Not a painting or a picture, but an actual living being, a living being in front of you. In this next exercise, consider that you have a living being in front of you, and it is a dialogue of love with that being. It's a dialogue of love. You're talking and having an experience of sitting next to one you love. Go back to the center. Don't move from the center. While you have your dialogue with your beloved, stay in the center, and there have your dialogue of love with your beloved. Close your eyes, go within, and enjoy and relax yourself. But don't go to sleep and don't move away from the center. You can use mantra to stay there. You can hear the sound to stay there. But have a nice dialogue with the beloved Master, who is your unconditional friend. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes. Look. I am sorry I interrupt some of your meditation. It's not supposed to be interrupted so quickly. I've just given you a few samplings of the different levels of meditation. First one was purely physical. How we can use physical mantra and physical body situation, try to find the third eye center. Second was about the sensory systems, how the senses operate within us independently. The third, when we used it for repeating with the mind, was the mental system, by how the mind can be controlled by repetition with the mind and listening to the mind. The fourth one was with the love and devotion, how that's important part, it's a spiritual way of meditation. And finally, I said you should be in the company of the beloved, which is ultimately the goal, that love is the ultimate answer. So these were little samplings. In a workshop like this, I can only give little samplings of what is supposed to be a way of life. The truth is that the meditation should not be done only for a little while. It is supposed to be a way of life.
If you adopt meditation as a way of life, you get far more benefit than merely doing it for 10 minutes or 20 minutes or 1 hour or 2 hours or 3 hours or 8 hours. As a way of life, one should do the mantra repetition as a matter of course, as a habit-forming thing. The mind should be made to have a habit of repeating that even while we are walking, we are talking, we are doing things, cooking, driving, should keep on mentally repeating that. The help is that when we actually sit in meditation, we don't have to do anything. The mind is automatically doing it. We just sit and listen. By forming that habit of the mind repeating the words, when we sit in actual meditation to go to the third eye center, the mind just picks up the thread by habit and repeats the words. It becomes much easier. Similarly, constantly thinking of the beloved and the Lord doing everything helps us in the stage of love and devotion. If everything that happens outside, we can think of the Lord, how he has done this little thing. People I know love to appreciate this parking spot wasn't available, one just got through. Thank you, Master. Thank you, God. This little thing came my way. Thank you. Every little thing that happens in life can be used to remember the Lord. If every little thing is used to remember the Lord, our whole lifestyle becomes a meditation. So that is how it should be. Meditation is not one specific thing to do. The rest of the time we have to do worldly things. We should keep the meditation running through our worldly things so that the worldly duties also become a spiritual activity. Then if we are doing a job, we should do the job. This is our duty given by the Master, given by the Lord for us to do. If we think of our job like that, even that job becomes like meditation. So we can do everything in life and make it into meditation. In which case, when you sit for a little while, the results are very quick because the rest of the time we are preparing for it. So life itself should be like a meditation. That gives your answer. Now today I have given you little samplings of what can be done. I wish we could sometimes have a meditation workshop where we spend some stretched hours, some stretched time to get results and not be disturbed by having to get up to do other things. Would any one of you like that? Oh, we can have. You have enough number to justify another meditation workshop. So where the main concentration can be on actually doing meditation. Of course, some guidance, so that if we run riot or go to sleep, somebody can wake us up. But beyond that, we should be able to get the results consistently over time. I'll try to arrange that sometimes and let you know. Did you find this workshop useful? Anybody found it useful, worthwhile? Thank you. Did anybody get from this workshop they didn't expect to get?
Different than now, I'm much calmer now. Anyway, I had tried meditating and it was a terrible ordeal for me. It was real scary. And it was really neat because when I meditated today, I actually felt the place of the third eye. I actually did all the things. And it makes me feel good because that means I'm learning and growing. And the newsletters, even though I live out of town, are really neat when they come. I want to thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing. Anybody else who got something they didn't expect to get over here? Yes. You got a nice meal,
yeah,
I know.
I didn't expect that.
You didn't expect to have a nice meal here. Yes.
Ishwar, I've had a real tough time when I close my eyes, I really feel like I'm just looking at the back of my eyelids. And today, sometimes when I'm going to sleep too, I see beautiful flowing clouds of a real light violet color, just a gorgeous violet. Today it seemed like I finally pulled back in, and then I saw rolling balls of this beautiful violet color, but I didn't hear any sound. But do they mean anything, you think?
Yes, that's the stage which comes in the just before the sound will come. You'll see the colors, then they'll flow into the sound. Colors flow into light. Sometimes you skip some of these stages, but it comes very often. Purple, blue kind of colors coming up, floating like clouds, floating like rolls, moving away on one side. That comes before that. Good. Congratulations. Yes.
I chose to do a little experimentation because when she brought up the word divine, I thought, hey, that's an idea. I'll try it. And when I did, I was sitting in a dome of light. Then in this last exercise, I chose to use a mantra that the little Maharishi with TM gave me 30 years ago or so. And instead, it was like I was inside of a plant and there was a murky, dirty green. So I went back to Divine and tried to clean it out. I didn't entirely succeed, but I did get reestablished the dome of light, but it was murky with this other mantra. She just asked, why is that? I'd like to know too.
No, next time clean it up fully. It won't bother you again. Next time clean it up fully. This time you only did part of the job. And it'll be okay. What was that?
She said a weed killer.
Weed killer. Now you'll get some help in the weed killing. Yes.
Color here, like a violet, and then maybe a yellow or something like that. Is that an aura or?
Those are astral colors.
The astral colors.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Violet, yellow, blue, these are astral colors. Okay. Red and beige colors are physical colors.
I see red too. I was talking to a man one time, he's quite angry, and I could see blue in his mouth. Now, I don't know what that meant, that I could see blue. And then one time I seen a lady, she had like a black eye, and I thought I was dumb, and I said, do you know you got something in your eye, around your eye? And she went into the bathroom, and she couldn't see it, and I felt like such a nut. And I know she looked through a scope, and so I thought, well, maybe that was, but no, I could see it even after that. So I don't know what that meant, but I did see like a black, not real dark, but around her eye. And it really wasn't there, so I learned to keep my mouth shut after a while.
Yes, I was going to say that.
Yes, I did. Well, I was ignorant, you know, I didn't know what that was. But
sometimes you see impressions from the astral self, but we can't tell them because can't see. So the best is to keep one's mouth shut.
Oh, yes, I did.
Yes.
You said that Apollo will put your attention in the third eye.
Mm-hmm.
What is this attention? Is it the self itself?
It's the self.
It's the self.
It's an extension of the self. It's the only part of the self that we have any control over.
Okay. So it's not part of the mind, is what I'm saying.
No. It's a part of the self. Mm-hmm. The self moves through attention. Of course, it's going through the mind, through the senses, through the body. Mm-hmm. But still the self is the consciousness. Consciousness is the self, and the only part of the self or the consciousness that we can use is attention. Okay? Yes.
Tim couldn't be here today, but he wanted to give this to you. He made it, and he wanted to get it. It comes with a stand, and he really did like your talk last night. And I think he thinks that you are on a good path, and he made this too for you.
All this for me?
For you.
Very sweet of him. Thank him for me.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Should we not be cooperatively developing more powerful and effective meditative techniques? Instead of simply reciting the same old things, make them more effective, make them productive.
Make them, you mean modernize them?
Beyond the ritual that I've heard again and again, don't you think we could make these better? Going into four-dimensional
mattress, yes.
For example.
Yes, yes.
I think we would.
We will be doing automatically as we move into the new civilization and new science and technology.
Cooperatively, I'm sure we can help each other.
I agree.
Go beyond the crude.
I agree. Technique. These techniques have evolved.
Yes.
Just like the status of the soul has evolved. Just like our other lifestyle has evolved. This has also evolved. And the meditational process should also evolve. I agree with you. And any contribution you make will be good for everybody.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes?
It will be a while probably before you get back, so I have to ask a question. We were talking earlier about this being the brain, the mind, and this being the level and bringing it up to here. And you said at another level that doesn't matter. On the other hand, in the Mahatma letters, there is a technique which you begin here, bring in to the center, and bring to the top of the head, which will bring about healing in this physical body.
Right.
And I know it works.
Yes.
And I know others have done it, and it works. And then there was a Dr. Beeler in California. Nowhere is this material published, but now that he's dead, I can talk about it. He had the ability, and it's teachable, to attend classes while he was asleep. And during those classes, he learned to use geometric symbols so that when he was examining his patients, he would put these symbols in different positions and bring about healing as he was examining them. And then he'd send them home with sugar pills. And he could do this when his patients were anywhere in the world, it didn't matter. So I guess in this particular area, who are these teachers on the other side? And they're available to all of us, and we sometimes get the information in our dreams, we sometimes get it by directly being in these classes and so on. Who are these teachers? Where are they coming from?
Now, we did talk about this subject briefly many years ago to deal with the first part of your question about the healing process that takes place. Like I mentioned, the six chakras below, the same chakra, when it reaches the sixth chakra, the same power, the same energy that comes up to the sixth chakra can ascend within the head on the physical plane to what has been called the Sahasra Budhe stage.
Yeah.
You heard of that, Sahasra Budhe, or the thousand-petaled lotus. The thousand-petal lotus is supposed to be top of that physical system and is responsible for all the energy balances of the physical system. And by attaining that, you can have healing of your own body. If you go deeper into it, you can also affect the health of this astral body, but certainly of the physical body. So that is a known method and people have used it. The second part is that what are these other beings or powers, especially these geometrical figures and other things that are happening there which can help, like Dr. Beale was helped, other people are being helped even today. The truth is that whatever has come into this world has come from the astral stage. Mm-hmm. The astral stage has been described by Plato, quoting Socrates, as the world of ideas.
Yeah.
The world of ideas is more real than this world. We don't accept it because here we are taking idea to be an imagination. That an idea is imaginary and that this solid material thing is real. It's an assumption we have made and we are living on that assumption every day of our life. But consider this. Plato tries to describe this. That if you did not have an idea of a chair, you would never have a chair at all in the physical world. Where did the idea of a chair come from which all the chairs have been created in this world? The idea of a chair preceded even the concept of a chair. And the concept led to one, second, third chair. So the idea of a chair was the reality of the chair. But then he goes on to say, it does not merely mean that somebody in his mind was able to figure out that if you make such a thing with a back and with feet and you can sit on it, and that will be a chair. It wasn't like that. That the chair, the ultimate chair, the idea of a chair existed somewhere. The chair itself existed, not one particular chair, but the chair as a whole existed somewhere from where all physical chairs could be created. Where did it exist? He says it exists in the world of ideas, which is the astral world. You will notice nothing exists in this physical world which does not have its roots in the idea of that thing in the world of astral ideas. Therefore, nothing is existing here which does not have its original concept, original version in the astral field. Now when we come to that, we want to explore more of the astral field. Those who are curious about it spend a lot of time in the astral field investigating these things. In the astral field you will find what we call numbers, which we think are merely conveniences for us to count, conveniences for us to calculate, are actually living personalities in the astral field. They are realities from which we make them symbols here. They are not symbols there. They are reality there. They are symbolic here. But they are performing the same function as symbols, what they are performing as real entities there. Similarly, all geometrical forms are reality there, and they are only symbols here. We are using them symbolically for our calculation, whereas they are real things functioning in the same way there. So when you have an experience in the astral world, you come across this extraordinary thing that you can meet triangles and squares. You meet some here too, I believe. You can meet twos and fives and sevens, and you can meet red and violet and yellows as beings, as personalities. These poor fellows, when they are in this physical world, become merely numbers and shapes.
Yeah.
But there they are not merely numbers and shapes. So they are performing a certain function. And that function in the astral region gives them the power that if somebody accesses them with that power, it can be used more than mere symbols in this world. And that's how they work.
All right, but the experience when you're asleep is that this is like an actual university classroom. And the person teaching it is as real as you are.
It's very difficult to say what is sleep. Because sometimes we feel we are in sleep when we are having an access to our astral self.
All right.
I'll give you a little definition of sleep and astral state. Most people don't know. They have trips into their astral self so many times without knowing. If you can have a dream or a dream-like experience which has yellow and blue colors, it cannot be sleep. Simple. In the ordinary black and white and ordinary red and flesh-colored scenes that come before you, it is sleep at a lower level of consciousness. So we have access to that so many times, it looks like we went to sleep and learned this. No, we learned at a higher level of consciousness. Yes?
Types of negative effects that can be played upon individual by using these astral things in the physical world?
Of course. I'll repeat your question for benefit of others. The question is that these entities roaming around in the astral and sub-astral regions, are they all positive and beneficial or are they negative also? A lot of them are negative. And therefore, I would not recommend that you go about meeting triangles and squares there. You meet yourself. The only thing that I am certain of is positive is your own soul, your own self. And if you strengthen that, no negative power can do anything to you. Otherwise, if you just go about visiting these entities, some of them can overpower you. So there is negativity also. There's a lot of negativity in this world, and there's plenty of negativity in the astral world. So you should be cautious about it. Don't be too adventurous about meeting these entities in these different regions. If you have the master with you, go anywhere you like. The master can protect you at all times. If you have a perfect living master with you, or if you have a mantra or a simran or words given to you by a perfect living master, go anywhere you like, repeat the words, be in the company of the master, no negative power can ever touch you. But if you don't have, walk cautiously.
You've heard of this placebo meditational inhibition, in which people are taught that this meditational healing can't happen, therefore it doesn't?
Placebo effect.
Placebo effect.
Yes. Yes.
The title of this workshop was Becoming Fearless. And I personally experienced a considerable amount of fear in my life. My young son was 7. From his very, when he was just days old, I could sense that he had incredible fear within him. But I also feel he's very special because he comes up with things, he's just like awarenesses that I think are, like he's aware of things. But he'll come to my room at night and say, "Dad, there's someone in my room." And I'll go in there, and there's no one in his room. I say, "Well, you were dreaming." But he says, "But he was really here." And then the next day he'll say, "Dad, people do come in my room."
Sure, I believe
that. And I don't dispel it, but is it okay for me to say, "Go behind your eyes," or should a master tell him that? Or what can I tell him to reassure him? Because he's really experiencing fear, and I can remember as a child that same type of fear. In fact, when he talks to me, I can relate to it so well.
So can I. I've been through that too.
What can I do for him? How can I help him?
Well, the younger the children, the more they can see. Uh-huh. I hope you believe that. We adults don't believe sometimes. Do you believe that a newborn child, yep, just coming out of its mother's womb, can see a lot more than we can? We don't understand it. Because that being has the memory of maybe several lifetimes in front of it, which we don't have. After birth, the forgetfulness starts.
Yep.
And we gradually fade out. And as we fade out, some of those experiences keep on happening, and we make them into objects of fear. Because we can only believe what is physically visible to us must be visible to somebody else. When the child says, "I see something," we say, no, there's nothing there. You create fear immediately. When we keep on telling a child, "No, it's not there," and we are trying to be helpful, actually we are creating fear. The child cannot speak. The child cannot tell you what he's seeing. because he feels you won't believe it, you just dispel it. So the child grows in fear and ultimately is able to dispel those experiences themselves in order to get out of the fear. So any visitations by other beings are stopped in order to overtake his fear. And we grow up and we say, oh, those were childhood fears. We just imagined, we saw things. And the blame is put on imagination. That imagination is responsible for all this. The ultimate solution is to go within and see how this happens. The ultimate solution is to be able to see what a child is seeing. But that comes by meditation. If you want to be helpful to your son, to your child, the best way you can do it is to go within yourself and then talk to him. He'll get his fear removed. Yes.
Of course, the children who have these beautiful visions or whatever we call them, if they meet a perfect living master, then they have no fear because they can talk to GM about. I mean, they can talk to the master about it, and he knows.
They can talk to the master, but they are still afraid. They can share their fears with the master, and the master can take care of the fears.
But he wouldn't take that. Would he take the gift away from the little kid?
No. He won't take a gift away, he'll take the fear away.
Oh, so the little guy can continue to communicate.
Yes, because...
in a spiritual way.
Yes, because great master used to give a practice of listening to the sound to little children sometimes.
Yes.
Very small children. Uh-huh. And they could listen to the sound and get over all their fears. Which can be done even now.
So
we haven't changed so much, I must tell you. We haven't changed in this world so much. Those things are still effective. And masters do help the children overcome their fears.
So the children aren't afraid then to talk to
right.
other people who may not see these beautiful...
The children are really afraid that what they are experiencing, others are not experiencing, that's very frightening. That something has gone wrong with the mind or something, that we are seeing some things, and they're frightening. Even we get frightened. If you see something and the others don't see, you're afraid.
Yeah.
We get scared of this. But if everybody else is seeing, we're satisfied, even if it's a horrible thing. Even if it's a beautiful thing and we are seeing it alone, and somebody says, I'm not seeing it, we are scared. The scare is not coming from the thing. Scare is coming from the fact, how come I am only seeing, somebody else is not seeing? I have gone crazy, I've gone something. Because we have been brought up with this assumption that only what everybody can see is real, the rest is imaginary. Which is not really true. It's not factually true. Yes.
Ishwar, regarding what you said about the astral level and the colors, the numbers, the ideas, I was always under the impression that that was in the realm of the mental level and that the astral had to do with feelings and desires.
That's true. It's in the mental. But from the mental, it trickles down as personalities in the astral.
Mm-hmm.
But their origin goes back to the causal, to the mental level. You're right. Yes.
I have a friend, a young man who was kicked in the head playing football when he was 17, and he got a massive brain hemorrhage, and they said it's hopeless, he will never live, but they operated on him because his dad insisted, and he lived through that, and they said he'd be a vegetable. Well, he's okay, except that he lost his recent memory.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, he's now 18 or 20 years later. He can't learn new things hardly, okay?
Mm-hmm.
They said he would never get any better.
Mm-hmm.
But he started seeing auras.
Mm-hmm.
So he calls me up. He could remember my phone number, but nobody else's. So he called me up, and now he calls me 2-3 times a week. And now he's gotten where he goes on the astral plane at night to heal people. And he reports all this back to me, and it's really amazing because he remembers this, but he can't go to school if he wanted to and learn the lessons, okay?
No.
But the thing is that he watches his dad sometimes, who is a commercial artist, and he'll just stand in the doorway and watch him because his office is in one of their bedrooms. And his dad is extremely imaginative, and he sees geometric figures flying out of his head, out of his aura, because he can see the complete aura. Now he tells me, in the last 2-3 years, that I'm with him at night, but I don't remember it, which I don't like very well. And I'm his guide sometimes, otherwise the two of us have a guide. And tells me about these remarkable experiences. And he's told me about things where you'd say, well, is it imagination? But now I have set up a deal where I would say, tonight we will do so-and-so, and I wait for his phone call the next day, and he tells me what I wanted to do. So I, you know, I believe now that he's really doing this. Do you think what would be going on where the neurologist said his brain will never get any better? He'll, you know, but he's improving all the time, not greatly, but he seems to remember the out of body experiences quite well.
His brain is not getting better. If the brain got better, he would remember things of this life.
Yeah, right, yeah.
His astral self is getting better because it's picking up something that he's remembering from just before he was born. He had that information with him just before he was born. He's picking that up, including information about the artwork that he sees has been picked up from that point. And that is his karma. He's getting this not by accident, but by karma.
Well, he told me that he's happy now that he had the accident, because all of his young friends got on drugs and they started stealing cars, and he feels like he's living a whole other life at night.
Actually, he's much older than his friends.
Pardon me?
He's much older than his friends.
Right.
In his astral or psychic age, astral or ethereal age, he's much older than his friends
right now. Very mature.
Exactly. So he's just going through the karma arising out of this accident, which has put him in touch with an astral experience prior to birth. Yes?
Are you familiar with the Enneagram, the 9-point personality system developed apparently 4,000 years ago by the Sufi monks to help you to raise to higher consciousness levels?
I have got some nice books on that. There was a Dr. Gyani who was in California, and he wrote some books on that subject. Very interesting.
About people being numbers, and in there they talk about people that are ones and that are fives and that are sevens.
That's right. It brings up all that. A lot of that stuff is from the astral world.
Does that tie in with what you were saying earlier?
Yes, it does. It does.
Thank you.
Welcome. Yes.
Yes, I was going to say now the astral realm, it doesn't have several layers, you might say, and the lower astral being pretty bizarre and maybe negative and so forth, and then the middle astral might be a reasonable type of realm, and then the upper astrals are quite a very high type of
that's right.
And the upper astral, would that be a place then where there's more in it, more the mental, like, you know, type of being and activity?
That's right. There are at least 10 levels in the astral world.
Oh.
Starting from the minimum sub-astral, which is part of our physical energy systems, going right up to close to the mental, where all the ideas are being transformed into senses.
Nice.
10 levels.
Oh, my God.
Anybody here? Yes.
Inferring from what you said about the experiences of children, it would seem that a lot of psychiatry induces fear rather than alleviates fear. Is there anything of value in psychiatry?
No, that's not all they do. Sometimes they help also. So wherever they help people, that is useful. Where they create fear, that is not good. But I am seeing the irony of it. Most of the fear these psychiatrists create is for themselves. They are the worst patients of their practice. I don't know if you are familiar with the statistics that the suicide rate among psychiatrists is the highest in the world. They while they try to help their patients, they get sick themselves. Ultimately, they die. They are more afraid. I have had to deal with some psychiatrists. They are really psycho cases.
I've discovered an inner master, if you will, in meditation, and I see their face, his face, but not all the time. Sometimes he fades in and out. And then he speaks. Is that just mind chatter? Or it's really good stuff, profound words of wisdom.
Enjoy it while you can.
Okay, but that's not mind chatter. That's really tapping into something.
Well, it could be either of them. It could be mind chatter, or it could be the real master, and at the right time you'll find out. Meanwhile, enjoy what you can. Yes?
About 7 years ago, I had a ruptured appendix, and I went in Sunday, and by Wednesday I was, you know, on morphine, and it was so bizarre. I mean, the bed was rocking, and it was just a very bad psychic space. So I told the doctor, so I didn't want any more morphine.
Mm-hmm.
I seldom think of this fear, but it just popped into my mind. One of my fears is that on my deathbed, the medical establishment is going to have me all pumped up with drugs. Is there any, is that detrimental to die all doped up? or should you die?
You can make a will and put it around your wrist. Please don't dope me when I'm dying. Under the laws of this country, you have a right to do it.
But is it detrimental to die with drugs in your body?
When you die, you go on to another state. This doesn't matter.
but
dying is not really dying. You see, we call it dying.
Yeah.
I have a hard time using that word.
Yeah.
Because you never really die.
Yeah, I know that.
So I have a hard time dealing with the subject of death because we never really die.
Yeah.
And we are always changing from one form to another. And we are not changing into a new form. Instantaneously, we are changing into a form that's been existing prior to our birth here. How can we call it dying? Like that, you would say that every morning when you wake up, you're dying in your dreams. We don't call it dying. When the dream ends every morning, are we dead in the dream or has the dream ended? We say dream has ended. The sleep has ended. We've woken up. Why can't we call the same thing here? This life dream has ended. We've woken up to an astral life. Now we might go back again. But that doesn't mean death. So dying is not a very healthy word because it seems to imply this is it. That's the end of it.
Ishwar, I use the wrong word. When your physical body goes to sleep permanently and you're full of drugs, what the theosophists call the etheric body, which is kind of the blueprint in a way of our physical, some of that can be dragged with you into the astral. Isn't that what makes, like some suicides and people that are killed suddenly, they will become earthbound, and it's actually because they are dragging this etheric matter along with their astral, and it keeps them back down at a lower level. Isn't that true?
The etheric matter and the mental impressions will go with you, but physical drugs will not. They stay with the body.
Okay.
Only the ethereal effect and the mental effect will go with you. The drugs will stay here with the body and die with the body. Okay. Yes.
When you were saying before about children being able to see entities that adults can't see, can that also be true of older people that are in advanced stages of Alzheimer's, that are, they insist that all these people are around them and they keep asking about your first husband and your first wife and your life?
That's true. The older people are, what do they call second childhood? They are in their second childhood.
Does that mean they're getting closer to leaving this?
Yes. Yes. I have seen in many cases when they start talking like that, they are ready to leave in a few years. The other thing is that it's not, some children see this because they are children. Some adults see it because they are still children. Some see all their life because they remain children all their life. Some even remain babies all their life. Yes, George.
About 10 years ago, I had a friend whose mother was dying from cancer. And I told him that probably there's going to be a period of time when she will start seeing strange things and you know, sort of getting in contact with the other world. And not, you know, not to be afraid for her or think that she's going crazy, but there's something different happening in the reality. Because I had warned him, he came back and reported to me. And he said that what was amazing is what occurred to her happened earlier in her life. And she would meet people who had died 25 years ago, stuff like this. She would do these things that maybe completed things that were going on in her childhood but didn't really happen or something. And that struck me as curious because that's like, is she going back in time or is she just fantasizing?
No, she is meeting people who are working back in time. Because on the other side, you could be working with things that have happened earlier or later, both ways. I'll give an example. Couple of recent examples. Peggy is here. Peggy might recall that when I visited her home, I met her father there. You recall that I talked to your father? And he was very happy to talk to me because I was very comfortable with him talking about people who are discussing some mathematical propositions, something about gravity that has not yet been discussed here. That's going to be discussed 20 years later. He was discussing those with those people visiting him, those entities visiting him now. But nobody wanted to listen to him, not even his daughter, not even his wife. I was the one who was willing to listen. He held my hand. He wanted to talk to me. At least somebody has come from the other side. He didn't distinguish between me and the other entities that were coming, because I was willing to listen to him. But what was surprising was the subject matter of the conversation. Of course, he's passed on. And so I could know that he's ready to go, but he's in touch with people who are doing work in the astral stage. So many mathematicians are working. So many scientists are working. I want to give you a brief glimpse of the astral world. It is not a hollow world of ideas and triangles and squares moving. They're real people who have died here. Personalities who had names at work who died here are there working. And they are pursuing, some of the very famous people are pursuing their work there. Here they had difficulty of getting their information and their knowledge and putting it together. There they have access to all the information they want. They can go to a library. Supposing there's a chemist who was doing work in his lab here. He can't find certain ingredients. He can go to a lab there and get everything there. In the astral world, the same thing is set up for him. He's very happy to be there. And he's working on the very projects on which he could not do work here. If you go and meet him, or he comes into you when you are about to move over, he'll talk of his work there as if it is commonplace. This is going on all the time. There are big libraries, books, and those books are not made of these paper covers like we have them here. They're books of knowledge. You pull them out, you can see the whole knowledge information in front of you. It's a very different world, a very interesting world. Yep. And people are there living for thousands of years working on these projects. So many of the great master's disciples who had chance to go there and did a little digression, just a little side trip into seeing what's happening in different regions, they saw some of these beautiful things happening. And they said if they didn't have a master, they would stay there forever. It's only the perfect living master who says this is only temporary stay. Let's move on, and took them to higher stages. So in the astral region, so much is going on, and these people who are working there, they interface with us. At the lower levels of the astral world, like he mentioned, there's a lot of interface with this world. And they're constantly in change. And somebody who's about to go there already has a preparation. There is a place earmarked before we leave this body. Just like before we are born, in the womb of a child after conception, when a woman conceives even a single cell, in her body, that single cell is designed for a person who may be walking about outside. That person is still alive in another body. And the new preparation is already made for a new body for that person in another woman's abdomen. So this is something that's going prepared in advance. So when a person is about to die, the preparation there has already been made. So people there know who's coming and when. So they interface with us during the last few years of our life. But if these people speak, we make fun of them. Say, they're all senile, Alzheimer's, they just don't know what's happening, insufficiency of oxygen supply, you know, all kinds of things, medical jargon we hear about them. Because we never gone there. Let these doctors who talk about it go there and see. They'll be able to know what these people are talking about. Yes?
When someone dies in the physical plane, goes to the astral plane, do they remember their physical life when they're in the astral plane?
Depends on their karma, how much they can remember. Memory is a very personal thing and is based upon individual karma, how much you can remember. So they remember the essentials. The memory is generally very clear on the lessons learned and very poor and hazy on the events of the lessons. It's a general formula. General principle of memory carried over beyond death is that the lessons learned are carried forward and you remember them. How you learned those lessons is forgotten. Even after birth into a new body, supposing from one human body, you are reborn, reincarnated, another human body, you will remember the lessons that you learned, but won't remember the incidents that led to those lessons. Very selective memory.
That one, a person dies here. Do they say, oh, I just died? I mean, do they?
They don't use this word death, only we use it for them.
Change form?
No.
What?
Like no, they don't even know that. They just move on. They're not even aware what death is. They just go see people crying. Why are they crying? For their body. They know, what body is that? That's my body. Why are they crying? And they move on and see other things.
And then are they born in the astral plane? Or they just go there?
No, they were already there. They're not being born, they're already there. They're grown up.
They maybe have lived for 500 years or 1,000 years before they were born in this body. The astral body has its own life, which is 1,000 years, 2,000 years in terms of physical time. It's much longer. You can have 10 births here while you have only one birth and death in the astral form.
But you're saying that people could be waiting in the astral plane for the person who's going to be dying in physical. Like, how do they know?
Because he's sleeping in the physical world. Just like somebody is sleeping here and we have to go and catch a bus, we'll wait for him. When he comes up, oh, are you okay? Wake, let's go. Just the same way. Yes.
Yes, your previous answer, I must have asked my question wrong, because in your previous answer, you explained everything I wanted to know.
Okay. Okay. Yes.
Talk about going in the astral plane when you're sleeping. What is it called when you're conscious? And what happens to your body and why?
When you're conscious and you go into the astral plane, that is the astral plane. You should be conscious. But sometimes you can have that experience and also know about this body. That is a connection between the interface between this body and the astral plane.
Why?
Because of your previous attachments to astral level. If you do certain kind of exercises in a certain life, which bring you in touch with those experiences, then they are repeated again. And you have the consciousness of this body, and yet you see these other things with you.
And how do you move on from that?
Take instructions from a master. Yes. Any other question or answer or comment?
One more if you can stand it. You probably don't know Jack Hauk of the Douglas Aircraft Space Station, manned space station, that I shared responsibility for designing some of these with him. He spends his vacation time going around the country teaching people how to do this metal bending, and with about a 40% skill in one evening. And we had one of these meetings here in town, and one of the couples came, and they brought their pre-kindergarten kid along to avoid a babysitter. And so the kid was sitting here, and he watched these grown-ups doing this mental big effort of learning. Wish hard enough, and this metal will soften, and you can bend the spoon. This little kid was sitting on the ground there playing with a bunch of knives and forks. He watched these. Oh, is that what you're trying to do? Without any training at all. He just didn't know that this was impossible. He bent these better than any of the experts, because he had not yet been taught that this is impossible. And we are doing a lot of our education in teaching people all the things they can't do. And I think we should encourage them to be able to do some of these things,
right,
and to choose which things to do rather than be told they can't do
right.
them.
We have a lot more power than we realize.
Oh, so much.
And the education and civilization is not empowering us anymore, it's disempowering us,
yes,
taking away those powers. It's sad, but it's true. I know there is a holy man in India called Satya Sai Baba. Anybody heard of him? He's got very fluffy big hair. And he's got a nice face. I've had a chance to meet him a couple of times, three or four times. Very good friend of mine. And he produces things. You know, just people go and they say, he's God. Why? Because we saw there was nothing in his hand. And he did like this, and he produced something out of nowhere. So he comes from a place in Andhra Pradesh. Actually, right now he has a Puttaparthi. I don't know if anybody of you has been there, an ashram there. But the original place from where he came, I happened to go to that village. And I said, do you know that you are lucky, you people, that you produced Satya Sai Baba, who has these miraculous powers? The little children were playing there. They said, yes, 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 we know. And they did like this, each one of them producing things. In the same village. I said, how can you do this? He said, in this village, everybody can do it. Yes.
Because of their imagination and their intuition and all that are much more powerful than we as adults. And I'm wondering why, of course I'm new to this, but I'm wondering why we don't have more schools for teaching our children and grandchildren about these things.
I also wonder why we don't have. But the powers that be, the political powers that be, don't want us to have that. It's politics. It's politics. The political power don't want us to have that. Well, their reasoning is that they are governed by consultants and advisors who are materialists and material scientists. They say, don't teach anything that can turn your children and yourself crazy, only accept that which is materially sound, materially real. So we are in the hands of materialists. And therefore spirituality has suffered. Therefore morality has suffered. Therefore good life has suffered. Therefore all these holy teachings that we talk about have become hypocrisy. And children have not been taught the right things. We should have those schools, as many as possible. That's what is needed really. If you want to save the human race, that's what should be done. At the earliest stage, teach them the right things. But we are teaching them the wrong things. Sometimes we don't teach them at all. Sometimes teachers are themselves afraid to teach. The real way will be if somebody comes to power who has these ideas and he can influence policy. The policy is being influenced by politicians and not by us. If somebody with vision and spirituality comes into power, we'll be able to change the shape of things. Unfortunately, in democracy and elections, it is the money power and material power that puts people into power. It's corruption that puts people into power. So how can those people be expected to have spiritual values? Last statement.
In regards to what she said, is that the reason there aren't as many schools of that thought is because then this church would be mad at that church. But the biggest thing is that's why we're here. That's why God gave us children, me children, because it's my job to help them on their spiritual path. And I think that's my job.
Very good statement. Thank you very much. I hope you all enjoyed the workshop as much as I did. And best of luck, and hope to see you again. Thank you. God bless you.